strives to block out the world and focus on the dangerous task ahead. They evaluate the competition. Today, all but one share a common goal. Beat the rookie. Stop Montoya.
It was a beautiful day. Sun beat down.
Mystery why rookie Juan Montoya is running so well. Not only is he a great driver, but he also has a great team, the one that's won the last three series championships. Today, Montoya is running down the dream of tying the record of four straight wins. And there's no better place to begin that quest than from the pole position. And that's where Montoya starts today.
I felt so good, like anything was possible.
Still looking for their first win. One of them, Christian Fittipaldi, coming off his first podium finish in front of his hometown fans in Brazil. Hometown advantage this week belongs to Helio Castroneves. Not him personally, but the team based in St. Louis, just across the river. But if he wins today, the city of St. Louis will adopt him, and they'll fulfill their dream as well.
Juan Montoya has a chance to make history here today, but let me tell you, there are plenty of veterans in this field that would prefer history remain as it is.
Paul, the entire paddock is upset that a rookie can step in and dominate this series. Every crew chief, every team manager, every crewman, and especially the drivers, want to stop Juan Montoya.
Then, too, Paul Tracy will start outside the front row. He's been very complimentary to Montoya, but I don't think he likes it.
Well, he might have respect for Juan, but trust me, Paul, he's got the equipment, the team, and the attitude to stop Juan from making history today at Gateway.
Gateway International Raceway ABC Sports presents the CART FedEx Championship Series. Today, round number six, the Motorola 300. 28 cars, 300 miles on a tight oval. The champ cars are ready to roar. And now let's take a look at how they qualified for the run here. On the pole, Juan Montoya, the target. He's led 343 laps this year. Paul Tracy is outside. His last win came here 2 years ago. In the second row, Helio Castroneves, racing before his car owner's hometown, and Patrick Carpentier. In the third row, Dario Franchitti, second in the point standing, and Greg Moore. In the fourth row, Adrian Fernandez, who won earlier this year on Motegi, and Christian Fittipaldi. Row number five, Robbie Gordon, the highest Toyota qualifier, and Jimmy Vassar. Row six, Michael Andretti and Cristiano D'Amata. In the seventh row, Max Pappas and Tony Kanaan. Row number eight, Jill DeFerrin and P.J. Jones. The ninth row, Brian Herta and Tarso Marquez driving for Penske. The 10th row, Roberto Moreno subbing for Mark Bundell and Scott Pruitt. In the 11th row, Mauricio Guzelman and Michelle Jourdain Jr. The 12th row, Alex Barron and Allinger Jr. and Alola. The 13th row, Richie Hearn and Shigeaki Hattori. And alone in the 14th row, Dennis Vitolo. So that's the way the field lines up, and we are ready to go racing at St. Louis Gateway International. The race is the Motorola 300. The cars are ready. We'll be back for the green flag.
Motorola 300. Brought to you by Motorola, a leader in wireless personal communications. Motorola lets you take your world with you. FedEx, proud sponsor of the FedEx Championship Series. Ford Motor Company, better ideas driven by you. And Brewery Fresh Budweiser, official beer of CART. This Bud's for you. This Wide World of Sports update brought to you by Mobile Speed Fast, the fastest way to get gas. It's free and it's only at Mobile.
Welcome back to St. Louis. Today, rookie Juan Montoya goes for four victories in a row. Now, that's a feat that has only been performed by Al Unser Jr. and Alex Zanardi. In 1990, Al Unser Jr. set the record for consecutive wins with four, taking the checkered flag at Toronto, Michigan, Denver, and Vancouver. He won six races that year and went on to win his first of two kart championships. Last year, Alex Zanardi matched the record, capturing four in a row with victories at Detroit, Portland, Cleveland, and Toronto, on his way to winning his second consecutive series championship and a third in a row for Target Chip Ganassi Racing. But at the same time, consider how long it took both Unser and Zanardi to get to those, as opposed to the six races that might make it possible for Montoya to see his fourth consecutive win. Well, here at St. Louis, we're looking at 236 laps. It's a 1.27-mile track. Real Key is the first through 25th position in this field, separated by less than 1 second.
Today, Paul, we've got lots of onboards. First off, we've got Richie Hearn back in 25th spot. He's traded to Swift for the ex-Robbie Gordon, ex-Ray Hall, 98 Renard. This is one of the views from the Ford Swift of P.J. Jones back in 16th. We've got two solid rows, starting with Michael Andretti in 11th spot. Right next to him is Jimmy Vassar in the Honda Renard. Here's the view from Robbie Gordon's car, starting in 9th spot. He's got a busy weekend this weekend. And finally, next to him will be the Ford Swift Newman Haas car of Christian Fittipaldi.
Let's go down for a final check pit side. John Kernan.
Jimmy Vassar told me earlier today that all he needed was a little luck. Currently, Jimmy 11th in points, only two top 10 finishes all season long. So a youngster in the paddock area gave Jimmy what he called a lucky penny. So Jimmy took that lucky penny, and he has it in his shoe. He's hoping to bring him a little luck from the 10th starting spot. Now to Marty Reed.
Track temperature has really risen. In fact, it's the hottest that it's ever been, 135 degrees since this weekend started. And that's going to affect the setup. And Parker, who guessed right is going to be the best question as we head into the start of this race.
Well, with the heat, Paul, what we're going to see is the air's less dense. The front tires won't be able to hold on as well because the aero load is less on the front of the cars. These cars naturally understeer with full tanks. It'll be interesting to see who washes up high these first few laps and who's able to make the adjustments and keep it down in the groove.
I'm most interested in Jimmy Vassar's lucky penny. If it worked for Dale Earnhardt a year ago, maybe it'll work for Jimmy today.
I hope it's got a lot of luck, Paul, because Jimmy needs it right now.
Morris Dunn, the engineer for the Target Chip Ganassi team. Of course, Juan Montoya and Jimmy Vassar. Real game that we're going to see played as the momentum picks up. And this is really the critical part of the whole start of the race, is how you can set that momentum going. It's going to be how Paul Tracy figures this start.
Paul's very good here, Paul. This is where his last win came 2 years ago. He's going to try to jump Juan if he can.
And Juan jumped out early. That has been his trademark this season. And they are not going to accept the start. They wave the start off. Generally, the rule has been don't get more than a car length forward. You really have to have the nose of first and second in the front row to be overlapping one another. The lap, of course, will count owing to the fact that there is limited fuel for each and every race. In fact, here, calculated out 1.85 miles per gallon, 164.76 total gallons. Waved off to start also at Rio. So maybe something is being said here. Let's not fool around with these starts.
Juan's very, very good on the starts and the restarts. He always seems to get a great advantage, but now we can see that the field's strung out. Jim Swintel, the kart starter, wants him side by side.
This time they come to the green flag, and it is in fact green as Montoya forces his way in front. Paul Tracy chooses to duck in. onto the backstretch. They dice back at fifth position. Montoya will come around to lead the first lap with Tracy in pursuit. Carpentier right there. Castroneves back in fourth place. Greg Moore, though, got a great start and dropped into fifth. There goes Moore. Now up at the front, Tracy in second. Carpentier just behind Tracy. Then the Lola of Elio Castroneves.
And we can see a little further back, Paul, there was almost some wheel banging going on between Adrian Fernandez and Dario Franchitti, but Adrian was able to make a great move going down the inside of turn one and got Dario, and now Dario's being challenged by Jimmy Vassar.
Jimmy Vassar made a move to the inside coming into the first turn, decided it couldn't get done. Franchitti a little bit back in the order there. There you see Jimmy Vassar has dropped off, but now here comes Andretti. Michael Andretti starting to work on Jimmy Vassar. John Kernan.
Paul, early problems for Juan Montoya. Have been told by the crew that his radio is not working properly. They can hear him, but he apparently cannot hear them. And they keep telling him, plus two on fuel, but they're not sure if he's getting the message because he's not replying.
Of course, when you run into something like that, there is a full set of hand signals that the driver can use to acknowledge that he is at least hearing what they're saying.
But right now, Paul, Juan is so in the groove. He's got such a great ability to concentrate at such a high level. I don't think he really cares at this point. He pretty much can call this race from the cockpit right up until that first round of pit stops. And I think he's just going to try to get the most as he can out of this car, run it as hard as he can, and try to put a bit of an advantage over Paul Tracy and the rest of the field.
Back to John Kernan.
And just as soon as I said he couldn't hear them, they have swapped radios out down here in the pits, and now Juan can hear them. He has responded the last time by. It was just as soon as I said that, all of a sudden the radio problem was fixed. So this team dodges somewhat of a bullet.
Movement on the start. Christian Fittipaldi was eighth, now runs 11th. Jimmy Vassar starting 10th, now up to 8th. And Michael Andretti jumped from 11th to 9th.
It's going to take a few laps for the drivers to get into the groove, to be able to adjust these cars with the driver adjustable sway bars that they have and the weight jackers to try to find a comfortable balance and then maintain that balance as they get farther down the run. It's going to take about 35, 40 laps before we see who's guessed right and who's guessed wrong with these hotter weather conditions this afternoon as far as will the cars stay under steering to neutral or who's going to go loose, because on an oval that's this fast, going loose, well, on any oval, Paul, is something that you don't want to have happen. But that's going to unwind here in the next 25, 30 laps.
Dario Franchitti moving on the sixth-place car of Adrian Fernandez. Adrian on the left. Franchitti with the orange dot on the nose. The 27 car.
In eight laps in, Paul, there's no surprise. Juan Montoya just turned the quickest race lap. Second quick was Paul Tracy, the only two cars in the 26-second bracket. Everyone else back in the 27-second bracket.
Paul Tracy's still working on the back end of Montoya, though not in a challenging position. This is the fight with Adrian Fernandez being challenged by Franchitti. Jimmy Vassar and Michael Andretti are just behind them. And then Robbie Gordon rounds off the top 10. Robbie Gordon and Roberto Moreno both racing here and then getting on an airplane and heading over to Indianapolis to run in the 83rd running of the Indy 500 tomorrow.
On board with Jimmy Vassar going down the long back straightaway. We can see him shift up from fifth to sixth gear there, Paul. On the brakes, just at 205 miles an hour down the back straightaway. They're pulling four Gs through turns three and four. There's a big bump.
Yellow, and it's Robbie Gordon. Oh, no, Robbie Gordon, who came into this race with high, high hopes. And, in fact, many people felt that he was capable of at least getting on the podium. Well, there's good news. Robbie Gordon climbs out of the car. Perhaps in a sad way, better news for the team because they will be able to load up and get out of here earlier than expected. But what a terrible disappointment. Card safety team wants to make sure he is fine, though he climbed out pretty quickly, and we have our first yellow of the day. So the field will slow with Montoya, followed by Tracy, Carpentier, Castro Neves. The top four. Greg Moore is in fifth. We'd mentioned that Robbie Gordon was running in 10th place. So what happened? You can tell very little from that. He's already solidly against the wall. Looked like a very quick spin.
But, Paul, what we are seeing is that for the very first test of this new energy-absorbing restraint device, you can see that the left front wheel is staying with the car. What we are seeing is the left rear wheel coming down, and now we're on board. See if we can get a better view of what happened. Wow, Paul, he got down low there. There's a big bump on the entry, and as he went over the bump, the car snapped ends. Nothing a driver can do at that point. You're just a passenger, and it's surprising to see it happen so early in this run.
Boy, and did you see how fast Robbie got his hands off that wheel as it twisted back and forth? So the Motorola 300 slowed for the moment. Juan Montoya jumped to the start, still the leader.
Miss Cart's greatest rookie in the Miller Lite 225 next Sunday at 4 on ABC.
Back at the Motorola 300 in St. Louis, Robbie Gordon got in trouble on the 11th lap. Now watch as he heads into the corner here. He gets it down on the rumble strip. Actually, though, he was crossed up before he got to the strip. So, point we want to show you. Look at the front wheels. Now, they're using the energy-absorbing restraints. This is the first time they've used those restraints.
And as he makes the impact into the wall, Paul, watch the left front right here. And that energy right there, that energy-absorbing restraint keeps that front suspension wheel assembly with the car, keeping it from leaving the car and going back into the track. Now, what it looks like, Paul, is that I can only assume because of the heat, the car was understeering a lot. Paul, he was running very low onto the track, which is an indication that the car was understeering. And there's a big bump, and the bump's a little worse right down here on the inside. And if you're running low, that can catch you off guard. Now, what we're seeing, these skid marks down on the inside here that go off in this direction are simply a result of the spin. He actually lost control of the car a little earlier. The bump's a little worse as you get lower on the track. And it takes just a moment to upset the back of the car, and it turns you straight around, just as we saw.
Now, those energy-absorbing restraints are capable of holding 12,800 pounds, and there are actually two of them on each side of the front wheel. It was interesting to me as we watched the ambulance show up over at the medical center, but Robbie looks okay. But one thing that we did see, though, was one of the rears come rolling forward on the left side of the race car.
Now, you could see the half shaft had separated from the car, and the entire suspension wheel assembly had left the car. Now, the fear there is that another car coming along in trail will catch that wheel and send it up into the air. Fortunately, it didn't happen this time. Now, they've got two straps, Paul, that are on that lower left front suspension on the lower A-arm on the leading edge, trying to keep that wheel assembly out of the cockpit area and just drag it with the car. And you can see it's doing exactly the job it was designed to do there as it just trails along in tow.
Well, you can bet a lot of engineers are going to spend a lot of time looking at that video. And Robbie has his first DNF since Vancouver last year. 17 laps are complete. We are still under yellow. This weekend, the ESPN Sports Century Tour rolled into St. Louis. The 18-month multimedia event reviews the greatest athletes and sports events of the past 100 years, featuring an interactive mall tour with a theater, telecast booth, and a memorabilia collection. And speaking of Sports Century, presented by General Motors, Sports Dynasties. Tomorrow, May 30th, here on ABC, the New York Yankees, the winners of 24 World Championships, and the Boston Celtics, who won 9 championships in 10 years. We are still under yellow. Aerial pictures here provided by the Honda Helicam. They take a look down on this 1.27-mile oval. And under the yellow, there has to be a very disappointed car owner in the person of John Menard. Marty?
Yeah, we're down here. We just got the medical report. He's got a bruised right lower leg, so that's good news, really, because he was limping in here.
Yeah, he was limping pretty good coming in. You know, we didn't want to start the weekend like this, and I hope we certainly don't end the weekend like this, but these things happen, and I'm just glad Robbie's okay and we can race tomorrow.
You feel like you're snake bit on this weekend? I mean, every time you try, obstacles get thrown in your way.
Yeah, I'm going to talk to everybody, see if we can't move all these races from Memorial Day to Labor Day or something. It seems tough, like a tough weekend.
John, better luck tomorrow.
Yeah, thank you.
So John Menard, now they make that that fast move, one state over to Central Indiana. And we'll take a look at the full field rundown as it stands now. 21 laps are complete, 236 the scheduled distance.
And, Paul, I'd like to explain a little bit. Someone might be wondering, how can Robbie Gordon crash? He's young. He's got great car control, great reflexes. Obviously, he's not fatigued. And really, the explanation can be fairly simple. These cars are very, very sensitive. On a hot afternoon like this, these are the slowest lap times these cars have turned since they've gotten here. Now, what happens, the slower the cars go, they aren't producing as much downforce. Therefore, the springs, the shock absorbers, the sway bars that the engineers and the teams have set these cars up with, now are too stiff for the lack of downforce at the speeds they're going. Combine that with the fact that we've got a handling problem. Oh, this is going to hurt, Paul. I hate watching this. This reminds me of a few bad memories of my own. Got a flash flyer there. Unfortunately, that's over quickly. But what ends up happening is that in a normal practice session, the driver would come right back in. If he had a handling problem, they would adjust the car and he'd go back out. Well, in a racing situation, if they've misguessed, the driver doesn't have that luxury. In most cases, he has to stay out. So what happens? Now the car's too stiff. It's not producing as much downforce. Robbie's trying to compensate for the handling problem by going in a little bit earlier in the corner. There's probably a place he hasn't driven almost all weekend. The bump upsets the back of the car because it's too stiff. It jumps up, and just that quick, you're backwards into the wall.
So now as we are getting ready to go back to the green flag, just a few vehicles back to station yet. One of the kart safety teams, there you see it up, working the area between 3 and 4. But consider this. Is this predictive? Jimmy Vassar in 1996, his first winning year with Chip Ganassi. 5 starts. Look at the wins. Look at the poles. But look at the difference in laps led.
Well, it speaks a lot about the consistency of Ganassi Racing, as we've talked about this season, the fact that they almost never have any mechanical failures. And the other point to be made here is that this team is so adaptive that on a hot afternoon like this, they are the most able to react to the conditions and give their drivers the most consistent cars, no matter what the conditions or the situations, from full tanks to empty tanks. But what you're seeing, Paul, is that Juan Montoya is able to dominate in such a diverse, difficult, competitive series. That's the amazing part of all these stats.
Well, consider this one. Since 1996, the winning percentage, if you're going to come into a team, come into Target Chip Ganassi as a rookie, because certainly that was the place to be. The percentages are awesome. Montoya now picks up the pace. Are Tracy and Carpentier going to let him get away with jumping? No. They may not be, and neither is the starter. They're looking for a little tighter start, and looks like Jim Swintella is not going to let him fool around too much. He waved off the start. Now he has waved off this first restart after a caution period. Marty Reed?
Well, you guys mentioned push and the possible cause of the earlier accident with Robbie Gordon. Helio Castroneves has called in saying he needs one full turn in the wing. He's got a terrible understeer problem. Next stop.
And, Paul, what they'll do is they'll address it with wing. They can also do it with tire pressure or increasing the stagger at the back of the car, putting a larger right rear tire on to help that car arc. But what happens is if they run the fuel load down, the cars tend to go neutral and then to oversteer. So, really, the drivers don't want to make a determination until right before their pit stop. But if it's that bad that he's talking about it now, it's bad.
Oh, look at this time. Paul Tracy stays with him. The officials confirm they did, in fact, want Montoya to do a little better start than last time. Tracy is right there. So is Carpentier and Helio Castroneves. Coming over to the backside, you saw the battle with Pappas, Kanaan. On board, Michael Andretti. Eighth place, ninth place.
Michael Andretti, one of the few drivers shifting at both ends of the track, Paul. You can see he's going down two gears there.
Look at this. As Pabst comes up to challenge Christian Fittipaldi.
He doesn't leave it out there very long, though, Paul. It's up in that gray area. It's very, very slick, and he did the prudent thing. He tucked back behind him.
These cars of Pappas and Brian Herta have been the fastest in the speed traps all weekend long. He wants to maximize that advantage and try to figure out how to get a run, how to set up Christian Fittipaldi to use that top speed to draft by him on the inside of either turns one or three.
At the same time, just another car back, Cristiano Damana is being challenged rather constantly by P.J. Jones. That's Tony Kanaan in the bright red and yellow car, the McDonald's car.
And it's a tussle there, Paul, because Cristiano Damana's been looking down the inside of Tony Kanaan, and while he's been trying to pick away at him, he's had company with P.J. Jones trying to get around him, so he's got one eye looking forward, one eye looking back. You're on the offense, you're on the defense, trying to play both sides at the same time.
So on that restart, the big move was Pappas around Kanaan so he could begin to do battle with Fittipaldi and Andretti. And P.J. Jones now working on Cristiano Damana. Paul Tracy is following Montoya now by 9/10 of a second. Then Carpentier, Castroneves, and Greg Moore. No change up at the front.
And if Castroneves has a big push, Paul, it's not evident by lap times. He's also dropped into the 26-second bracket with Montoya and Tracy, everyone else still in the 27s. So I can only say that everybody else is suffering the same understeer that Castroneves has. It's just apparently bothering him and making him a little bit more vocal at this stage of the race.
170 miles an hour, 170 and a half for the leader as he came around last time. On that restart, too, Michelle Jourdain was able to get around Tarso Marquez for 18th. Tarso in his second race with the Penske team. And it looks like Penske for much of this year will be with a two-car team and probably with a full two-car effort next year. He was announcing just that, among some other things, last night here at the track. On board P.J. Jones now. We mentioned that he'd been working on Cristiano Damana.
You can hear two downshifts there, Paul. Normally in qualifying, it's only... Whoa! A big move by P.J. Jones. He got right down on the inside on the rumble strips, and those rear tires were just a little bit wider than the fronts as far as how far they stick out. He got on it, stepped right out. He did a great job of saving it.
Looking at the Kmart telemetry for P.J. Jones.
Watch the acceleration over 200 miles an hour as he comes down the pit straightaway. Hard on the brakes, downshifting two gears.
He's going to come out completely because we've got one of the Penske cars in trouble, and that's Marquez. So Tarso Marquez, who had, in fact, been involved in a battle a little bit earlier, catches the wall, and we have our second caution of the day. But again, obviously, no problem for Tarso. He climbed immediately out of the car, though he left quite a bit of Penske debris. Now he sits down. Let's hope he's okay.
Yeah, he had quite a bit of a limp as he came down the banking there, Paul. And I tell you, he'll get chewed out for getting out of the car that quick because the kart safety medical team wants to remain in the car till they get there. Crossing the track in front of other cars isn't the best idea in the world. Plus, you may not know you've got injuries because of the adrenaline that's pumping through. They want you there until they get there. Although your natural reaction is to get clear of the thing that just tried to hurt you.
Now we've got a replay of the crash. We'll actually join right at the end of it. There it is, already against the wall and coming off the wall. Though most of the hit obviously came to the rear end of the car. You can see how fast he threw off the steering wheel and started to climb out of the car. Again, that fire, that's oil within the turbocharger in most cases, or the gearbox that lights up when it contacts a hot surface and then it burns off quickly.
It was a little bit later in the corner than Robbie Gordon's crash. We'll have to see if we can find a better replay, but even at this point, Paul, they've burned some fuel of his cars trying to transition from that understeer to a neutral or oversteer car, and it's 33 laps in, and I knew it'd be around 35, 40 laps. That big bump that's on the entry of turn three is all it takes at these reduced speeds than they've run all weekend to cause the car to step out and swap ends on you.
And as you can see, as a result, as soon as the pits are open, we're going to see some of the key players decide that the 34th lap may in fact be an appropriate place to make the first stop. The best guess is that Juan Montoya will be one of them. Look at Paul Tracy. He is not going to let go of this guy. Even running around under the caution, he is right there.
And the pressure's on the teams, Paul, because they know that oftentimes this year the easiest place to pass has been in the pit lane. These guys are all so good, the cars are all so even, that racing on the track has just become more and more difficult. If a crew can service their car just a little bit quicker, they can gain that all-important advantage.
And the Target Chip Ganassi team has been good at that this year.
Absolutely. There have been a number of times when Juan Montoya has come in second place and left the leader. And trust me, every crewman up and down this pit lane is aware of that fact, and they want to get their guy back out in front of this young Colombian driver.
Every team at their home base, at their shops, the last thing they generally do in the day is to bring one of the cars out and go through practice pit stops. Pits are still closed, and the kart officials say next time by, they will open the pits for the first time. And, well, as you can see it right there, almost everyone in the front of the order is laid out, ready to accept their car for some stops. Now, a couple of teams back on lap 14 made a stop. That would be Richie Hearn, Roberto Moreno, Mauricio Guzman, and Allinger Jr. They stop. Also stopping early, Dennis Vitolo and Shigeaki Hattori. So they've already stopped, and that will affect the order for some time. Field over behind the Dodge Viper GTS pace car. In the third turn now. And there comes the entire lead order off the field. First to get to his pits should be Elio Castroneves. He has pitted up the way just a bit. First of the lead order. And Marty, you're there waiting.
Yes, we are, Paul. In fact, the word is now Castroneves' push has gotten even more severe. They're going to put two turns in. He's making his way down towards pit lane and should be pulling in very quickly here. He missed the pit. He missed the pit.
Wow, you've seen the nine car coming right back out. As Jimmy Vassar comes in for his stop, John Kernan, Montoya's in too.
And he didn't miss his pit. It was a four tire change. No, very close, 10.1 seconds, but he is going to be beaten out of the pits. They had talked about not coming into pits, but Juan thought that he might have run over some debris from the crash out there with his right front tire.
Well, he not only got beat out of the pits, he got beat out of the pits big time.
Big winners, Paul. We can see Greg Moore and Patrick Carpentier, as well as Paul Tracy, got out. These guys have been working very, very hard at their shops, and it paid off.
Jill DeFerrin, they have a crew member down at the back of the pits. Apparently, an incident occurring during this stop. We'll keep track of that for you. And DeFerrin, damaged to the side of the car, and... Well, we don't want to speculate at all. Derek Walker, the team owner, is actually standing out on the pit road along with the safety team. And Jill DeFerrin, the car is quiet for the moment. So under this caution, a good many things happening. And this coming on the 37th lap. Right now, Tarso Marquez got into the wall. And that brought out this particular caution period. Now, Marty, you were talking about Elio. And we were hoping he would come in, but then he had problems.
Yeah, he just flat missed the pit entry and had to go on through. Now, the team has made the decision he is going to stay out. Now, he wanted two turns in that front wing. He does have enough fuel. Remember, we've had plenty of laps of caution. And even on a green flag situation, we'd be looking at lap 60 before anything would happen. Now, you can see if you're looking at the pit's window further down the road, he can probably get about another 40 laps, 45 laps, somewhere in that range before he has to stop. But that push is going to be very severe.
Well, looking at it again there, you do have to wonder, what was it that Elio Castroneves turned back out? Because it looked at first like he had his pit figured out and was going to head straight into it. Roberto Moreno picks up the lead. Our Toyota Spotlight focuses on Paul Tracy. It was here 2 years ago at Gateway International that Paul Tracy, then driving for Roger Penske, scored his last victory in the Champ Cars. And then in the qualifying, for a good part of the time, Paul Tracy had the pole position. It was, in fact, only in the last minutes of qualifying that his pole position was snatched away by Juan Montoya. And then today, the race that may have actually counted the most is Paul Tracy got out of the pits ahead of Montoya. Now, we do want to point out there, you saw it, there was a crew member down in the Walker pits, the team for Jill DeFerrin. We have no new information on that, but we are looking for appropriate information. We don't want to speculate on anything one way or the other. We have no information. Once it's given to us by CART, we will pass it on to you. Let's go to Marty Reed.
Well, guys, more information on what happened with Helio Castroneves and the blown pit stop opportunity. Take a look and watch now. You see the two players' cars, and the meat in that sandwich is number 9. Now, he swung out, and Helio said, I could not make it in because see the tire right there? He felt he was going to hit the tire, and so he decided he had to continue on. So it was a decision made in the cockpit that Helio would have been up the front wing had he pitted, and right now it's going to cost him dearly.
But what that does is puts him currently in fourth place behind Moreno, Hunter Jr., and Hearn, who stopped earlier. He can't very well have come around and come back in because that would have run him all the way to the back of the field. We'll be back. Back at St. Louis under the green flag, Roberto Moreno brought him back to green, but boy, they have been chopping at one another. Look at that red car. That is Juan Montoya as he tries to work on Helio Castroneves. He's already battled it out with Moore and with Paul Tracy, and at the same time, at the front of this order, Richie Hearn has been able to dart out and around and move into the lead. Now remember, Hearn, Moreno, Hunter Jr., they had not stopped. They stopped earlier and didn't stop on this last cycle of stops. Neither did Castroneves.
And significantly, Paul, Richie Hearn is starting to pull away. He's in a Toyota-powered car. He's in a 98 Renard. This is the first weekend. They just got it from Robbie Gordon's team. This is phenomenal. And Juan Montoya has figured out he's looking for clean air. He's gone to the high side, the low side. He snookered Paul Tracy, Greg Moore. Phenomenal bit of racing.
Moreno came back to the lead. Hearn was out alongside him just enough to come across the stripe and then drop back in. Wonderful battle. And now Castroneves working on Al Unser Jr. Leo Castroneves, there's Unser Jr. just ahead of him. Montoya, Tracy, Carpentier, and Andretti have broken off for the moment. We'll see how fast Montoya is able to close on Helio Castroneves.
Now keep in mind, Paul, these two cars, the Penske and the Hogan chassis, are both Lolas, or the teams are both Lolas. The difference, Al's on Goodyears, Castroneves is on Firestones, they're both Mercedes-powered. Everybody in the field's got a fresher set of tires on than Castroneves, but Castroneves has a lighter fuel load, but he's the only driver in the field that hasn't been able to come in and make an adjustment to the handling of that car. But yet he's looking very, very racy behind Al Unser Jr.
Unser Jr., though, using every inch of the track. And I got to tell you, I am somewhat surprised as we take a look at the line as Roberto Moreno comes across. I am surprised that Montoya, Tracy, and Carpentier have not really made that much of an improvement except to say that they're sitting on full loads and new tires. But their tires, surely under this temperature, would be up to speed quickly.
Well, they would be, Paul. It's that fuel load. Remember, the 35 gallons of fuel is a huge percentage of overall weight of these 1,550-pound cars. So the difference in 150 gallons or 150 pounds of fuel with half tanks and full tanks can make a big difference, and I think that's what you're seeing right now.
Last time around, Tracy was the fastest, followed by Helio Castroneves. This time it changes, at least to this point. Roberto Moreno is driving that car.
He's driving it extremely hard. It's a difficult situation to step in with a team without doing all the testing and building all the rapport. We spoke with Bruce McCaw, the team owner of PacWest, last night. He said Roberto's been a great fit. He stepped right in. But still, from a driving standpoint, you need those miles of testing. But in Roberto's case, maybe you don't, because he's doing a great job here leading this race.
Moreno overhauls Dennis Vitolo. We're going to go on board with Richie Hearn. That's Al Unser Jr. just behind him, behind little Al, Castroneves, and Montoya. See Castroneves take a peek to the inside. Al's been running the wide line into these corners.
What he's doing, Paul, is he's trying to stay as low as he can keep that Lola chassis to try to take the air off of the cars behind him. You can see him draft up and around Dennis Vitolo there. And unfortunately, Castroneves got blocked, which is exactly what Al Unser Jr. wanted to have happen as they come off of turn two. You can see the distance now as Al moves around that he was able to put between himself and Helio Castroneves.
Tracy makes it past Vitolo. Leaders are all back in contact again. And closing in, it begins to get tight behind Richie Hearn. Moreno is over 2 seconds ahead of second place Richie Hearn, not even in the shot when he comes on the straightaway.
And it's pretty obvious that Castroneves is quicker here, Paul, because he was able to make that gap right back up to the back of Al Unser Jr. Al's got to use the momentum and try to figure out how to get around Richie, because if he doesn't do it soon, Castroneves is going to find a way around him very, very soon.
Castroneves looks to the inside. Hallinger Jr. won't let it happen. He didn't have the steam anyway. That loses a little momentum. He drops back. Montoya still sitting about 75 yards off the back of Castroneves' car.
Castroneves getting another head of steam built up here, Paul, to try to figure out how to get a good run coming off of turn four and draft up and make it stick.
Yeah, but little Al's going to work on Hearn as Hallinger Jr. comes to the inside of Richie Hearn, gets it done, and separates himself from Castroneves.
Castroneves has got to make quick work of Richie Hearn here unless if he wants to stay with Al.
Again, Castroneves can't get by. And we want to give you the update as we have it at this moment on the situation involving the crew member from the Derek Walker team. John Kernan?
I just talked to one of the crew members, and they told me that it was Dave Stevens who handles the hose for the vent, and the air jack just didn't get out of the way quickly enough. He ran over by the left rear, but they say that he is going to be okay. The crewman said that he wanted to get up, but they made him lie there on the ground and wait for the safety crew to get there. He's been taken back to the medical center to be checked out. So the good news is from the crew member, that's very unofficial from the crew member of the Walker team, that they would be okay.
Yeah, that is good news. We'll wait, of course, for an official posting on that as well. Castroneves makes his move. Now
I'll
Montoya.
I'll be afraid to click it up just for a couple laps.
Montoya all over Richie Hearn.
When you heard him say click it up for a couple laps, they mean to go to full power there, Paul, to try to get a run, because if he doesn't get around Richie Hearn, Paul Tracy's going to be...
They might want to use that overtake button once in a while, too, Paul.
Okay, there we heard the communication to Paul Tracy, trying to make sure that he can use Richie Hearn as a pick, as an advantage, to try to get around Juan Montoya. But I can tell you, they're giving the same advice to Juan Montoya. He's got to get around Richie Hearn quickly, or Paul will use that to his advantage.
Watching Montoya at the front, it's still Roberto Moreno substituting for Mark Blundell, who rolled his car in a ball and was injured here in testing a couple weeks ago. Tracy now moves with Montoya. Montoya and Tracy go side by side in the corner. Montoya way high as they come off the corner.
Big wiggle there, Paul. He got up in the gray, and that shows that those young, quick reflexes are worth every penny because he was able to keep control of that car. If we can see it move, it's a big, big moment, but he was able to keep control of the car. Paul Tracy, a brilliant move, timed the draft perfectly, and dove right down under braking to take advantage of Juan Montoya.
Oh, how many times this season have we seen that, though? He is so quick with his hands, saved the car. I can think of at least five different times when we've watched him when he had the thing almost totally sideways. So Roberto Moreno leads it at Gateway International in the Motorola 300. We'll be back after this message and a word from your ABC station.
The Motorola 300, brought to you by Roundup, kills weeds down to the root. Roundup, no root, no weed, no problem. Mobile One, nothing outperforms Mobile One. And Turtle Wax, for a breakthrough shine in no time. Turtle Wax.
Paul Page with Parker Johnstone. We're at the Motorola 300 in St. Louis. This is the battle, first, second, and third. Roberto Moreno, then Hallinger Jr., then Elio Castroneves. They've pulled away from fourth place. Richie Hearn, look down the straightaway. There's nobody there, and it has been a fine little battle. Moreno is holding his own. We take a look at the guys on the move. Well, obviously, Moreno, Hallinger Jr., Hearn, they all really did that with some strategic planning on their pit stops. Marty Reid?
Yeah, let's update you on Roberto Moreno. He stopped at lap 14 for fuel only, so he's still on the same tires, but they feel they can go to lap 85 before they'll have to stop again. As far as Richie Hearn, he lost touch with that group, Paul, because he says the handling's starting to go away.
The only other thing that occurred while we were away is Max Pappas was able to move up into 12th place right now. So with 166 laps to go, upper left, we run through the corner for you. Roberto Moreno, interestingly enough, the last time that he led in a kart race was in Detroit of 97. At that time, he was substituting for Christian Fittipaldi. Close, now traffic ahead of him. Going to get interesting here.
Just like basketball, if you're the trailing cars, you want to pick in front of you to try to bind up the momentum of the lead car, and that's exactly what they've got in front.
Allanser Jr. and Castroneves in these two Lola cars working extremely well, waiting to catch up to Jourdain Jr. to see if they can't get a run on Roberto Moreno.
Christian Fittipaldi just got around Tony Kanaan for 14th. And that'll be Brian Herta, who lies just ahead of them. He is 21st right now.
That's a pretty amazing story, Paul. You've got a substitute driver leading. You've got the Penske team that had very little test time in this Lola chassis in second place. And then the underdogs in Hogan Racing with Castroneves in third place. It's kind of a Cinderella story.
Allanser Jr. is going to give it a shot again as he comes down, works on Roberto Moreno. Again, slower traffic just ahead in the person of Michel Jourdain Jr. Michael Andretti was able to get around Patrick Carpentier for seventh. Allanser Jr. ducks it inside, still no cigar.
And here comes Al. He's got a great draft.
Here's Allanser Jr. He's got a run. Very, very nice.
This is when you almost hold your breath, Paul, because every time we've seen Allanser Jr. go into the lead, something's happened.
Anilio Castroneves finally works it down onto the pit road. John Kernan will be waiting for him as Castroneves comes out of third, down onto the pit road. Unser Jr. is into the lead, and that brought the crowd to their feet. They like seeing little Al out in front. So here is Elio Castroneves after his aborted stop before, John.
And it'll be a four-tire change, of course. The tires coming off, going on. Also expect him to put two turns in the front wing, trying to get a little more downforce on the front of the car to loosen it up just a little bit. The car very, very tight, so they do a fine stop. And Castroneves is down and away.
Paul, did he say that car was running tight? I just wanted to make sure. I think John's been at the Winston Cup races a little too long.
You know, we were talking about it with John yesterday about how interchangeable all of the language has, in fact, become recently with race fans crossing over all the series so readily. Allanser Jr., Roberto Moreno now sits in second place. There he is behind Allanser Jr., just coming across the line. He, of course, is substituting for Mark Blundell, who was in a crash here. Mark's joined us in the broadcast booth. Pretty cool to see that car out in front, but I wonder if it's cool with you not in it.
It's fantastic to see the car out in front, but I'm not in it, so it's just a big shame for me. But, you know, great for the team, great for Motorola. It's our home race here, and Roberto's doing a great job.
Well, there's a lot going on here, and we may end up interrupting you from time to time, but can you review your situation? You had an accident here while testing the car.
Yeah, big accident here, Paul, while testing. 3 weeks ago. We're going to go into the doctors next week, get some x-rays done, and hopefully they're going to tell us we're going to be in shape for 3 weeks' time in Portland.
On the move, Michael Andretti just was able to handle up Juan Montoya. Now he's working on Richie Hearn. So you told me you were thinking of coming back by Portland. Do you really think that's realistic, or is that going to be an argument with your doctor?
Well, I think it may be a little argument there. I've actually got a fractured neck at the moment, and that's not so conducive to being in a race car at this point in time, but I desperately want to get back in my car. Portland's my target. Let's see what the doctors say.
All right, once again, the Derek Walker crew member that was down, John Kernan, can give us a further update.
I'm over at the medical center, and what I've been told is it a possible concussion only for Dave Stevens. He had a helmet on, and they said that probably kept the injuries from being any more severe. There was, in fact, a crack in the helmet, I guess, from when he hit the ground. But the good news is Dave Stevens is pretty much okay. Possible concussion. They are going to transport him from the racetrack here, take him to a local hospital so he can get a CAT scan and be checked out further. But I think that's some really great, great news.
You got a glimpse of Richie Hearn as he pulled off. He's in the pits now.
What a tremendous story. They just took delivery of this car. The Swifts of Della Penna have moved over to Robbie Gordon. They've taken delivery.
Oh, he stalled it.
What a shame. He was running so strong, but they've taken delivery of Robbie's Renards. And in fact, tonight, Paul, they take delivery of a 99 Renard. And I tell you, to show up in this paddock with a car that you haven't tested with, no data, no information. I was talking to their engineer, Steve Conover, and they're doing a tremendous job for just coming straight out of the box with this year-old car.
Oh, and these hot temperatures to get that methanol fuel to come back through the fuel injection system took a little while for Richie Hearn. Now he's rolling. Allanser Jr. still the leader. Half a second back is Roberto Moreno. But you see something like this, Mark Lindell, no disrespect, but do you feel threatened at all with Marino doing so well, or do you assume the team's just finally done a good job?
I don't feel threatened, no. I mean, I'm just happy the car's going well, and, you know, hopefully we get a great result. You know, I'm driving that car in spirit at the moment, and threatened, no. I'm going to be back in my race car, back with my team, a few weeks to go.
All right, there we go. Marino really has the spirit of two drivers in the cockpit. I hope you can hang around, stay with us for a little while. Mark Lindell here in the booth with us. There is his replacement, Roberto Marino, who leaves here, heads over. He's going to do the double this weekend as well. Now they're expecting the leader, Al Unser Jr., to hit the pits in 2 to 3 laps. Now Michael Andretti and Paul Tracy then really become the keys in this race. It's Unser Jr. followed by Marino, and then Tracy, Andretti, and Montoya.
Look how low he's running that car, Paul. He's right down on the white line going through turns 1 and 2. Very, very typical of Michael Andretti. He goes in early and keeps it down low. They're just over 205 miles an hour here. Just a lift over the bump. You have to be very careful bringing the throttle back up as we watch Michael slowly disappear from Richie Hearn.
Of course, the pass there, which puts him up a bit, that really is a result of him coming out of the pits, Hearn coming out of the pits and running slow for a bit there. Expecting Al Unser Jr. in here. In fact, he is. On the pit road, Al Unser Jr. comes out of the lead. We'll turn the lead back over to Roberto Marino. And here's Marty Reid.
Roger Penske talking his driver in. They're very pleased with the way the car's performed. Al radioed in and said, don't change a thing. So this should be fuel and tires only on this new Lola that they just literally got into this week. And he's back out here, and they're waiting for the fuel to top off. And he finally gets out 12.4.
Two races in a row, the pit strategy has put Al Unser Jr. in front or in striking position of the front, but now he makes his stop under green, and that will send him well down in the field. Here is Carpentier as he battles with Dario Franchitti. This is a fight for fifth place.
And Paul, we haven't talked about it yet, but if you look at the nose of Patrick's car, you can see that there are two fins extending to either side. Those are called nose strakes. And just behind the front wing, there are two more tabs called chassis strakes. Some of the teams, after PacWest debuted them at Nazareth, have come here trying to get a little bit more downforce on the front of the car since they're running the smaller super speedway wings here at Gateway. Now, there is a drag penalty associated with it. You won't see them on the target cars. You won't see them on the team green cars. But some of the teams were trying to balance the car, trying to get some more downforce at the front. And Renard provided a kit to all the teams for this race weekend.
Notice that battle runs just behind Montoya. And you got a glimpse of Al Unser Jr., who came out able to split the distance between Franchitti and Adrian Fernandez. And that slides him into seventh place. And now Roberto Marino is on the road. Mark Lindell, you want to keep track of this for us as Marty Reid watches from the pits.
Yeah, Roberto's obviously coming in now. He has to make sure that he slows the car down. And at this point, it's critical that he stops on the marks. He's done a pretty good job there. The guys are going to work furiously to get those wheels and tires on, dump the fuel in, and get him out as quickly as possible. So far, it looks a good stop, looks clean. This is always a nail-biting moment for us drivers. We don't want to stall the car. And he's got away successfully. Good stop.
12 seconds for Roberto Marino. Marty Reid, you could be in trouble because Mark Lindell did a nice job of calling that one.
I'll tell you what, he can wear the fire suit and come down here and do it. I'm running down here like crazy, and he does a great job. Good one, Mark.
It's so nice to see the Motorola car running so strong here in their home race. Having driven for Motorola for a few years, I know there are a lot of Motorolans in the stand on their feet, applauding this car and cheering it on. And a great group of people, a great company, and it's nice to see them leading their home race.
So with the stop, Paul Tracy picks up the lead, followed by Michael Andretti, Juan Montoya, and Patrick Carpentier, then Dario Franchitti. Those are the top five. Don't forget, not only racing today, but coverage tomorrow, the 83rd running of the Indy 500. We're going to show you the top of the field. With Paul Tracy in the lead and Michael Andretti beginning to work on it. And don't forget, here on ABC Sports tomorrow, coverage of the 83rd running of the Indianapolis 500 starts at 11 o'clock Eastern time. One of the guys doing double duty is this car, Roberto Moreno, who was in the lead for a while. Also, Robbie Gordon, who was the first out with an incident, crash against the wall. He, too, will make the double. Now coming back up to the front, Paul Tracy is really flying now, Parker.
He is, but the fastest car on the track is that car that's in his mirrors of Michael Andretti. He's been a consistent 2 to 3 tenths of a second quicker than any car on the track for the last 10 laps, Paul. I think it's just a matter of time before Michael starts to try to figure out how to get around Mr. Tracy.
And something we have not seen this year. Not only is Juan Montoya not at the front of the field, he is a full 5, almost 6 seconds behind the leader, Paul Tracy. You ride with Michael.
The Fords and the Mercedes drivers are shifting coming into turn three. Now, the Toyota and Honda drivers aren't. In fact, Mark, that's where you got in trouble during testing when you had a gearbox problem on the downshift going into turn three and the car locked up and turned around on you.
Yeah, exactly. It's just a little bit of a problem that we have with our drivability on the engines. Unfortunately, we have to downshift, but they're working on it, and I think they've got improvements in the pipeline now.
Paul Tracy due into the pits in 2 laps, less than that, lap and a half now. Last stop on the 36th lap. Michael Andretti has to handle up. Cristiano D'Amata comes to the inside and around, maintains contact with the lead. Would assume that Michael Andretti will come in at the same time that Tracy does. We watch for both teams to lay out. Paul Tracy on the road. Michael's not going to come in. So Michael Andretti will pick up the lead of the race as Paul Tracy comes in for his second stop of the day after turning some blistering laps, but turns the race over to the even faster Michael Andretti. Let's go to John Kernan.
Paul Tracy radioed in just a few laps ago, and he said, no changes on the car, no changes on the car. Apparently, he likes the way the car is running, and why not? It had him up into the lead. He slows it down, hits his mark, and now there will be air jacks come up, tires come off. Looks like a very smooth stop so far, waiting for the fuel, waiting, still waiting. He's got the revs up really, really high now.
Goodbye. Paul Tracy roars out 13.
Well, Paul, that was a good bit of strategy. Just before Paul came in, he was about ready to catch a group of 3 cars, and rather than slowing down, he dove into the pits. Now, you take a chance of a yellow coming out, but they want Michael to get bottled up in that traffic and slow him down so they can take full advantage of a clean in and out and a great pit stop.
Getting a glimpse here of the fight for sixth place as Christian Fittipaldi and Jimmy Vassar were battling. But now Michael Andretti is in the pit. So is Adrian Fernandez. Let's go to Marty.
Yeah, Michael Andretti really needed this stop. He is out of tires. They did not change tires the last time. So he's run 105 laps on those first set of Firestones. The other side of the story, Christian Fittipaldi stayed out. And he did get fresh tires last time. So Andretti's out of there.
Jimmy Vassar is in, Montoya is in. Fernandez got caught up with a very long stop. Mauricio Guzelman in trouble over on the backside. Let's go to John Kernan.
And the telltale sign here is where my mic comes out that the engine is not running on Juan Montoya's car. He ran out of fuel. So they're going to have to fire the car up now. He is full of fuel, but now they're waiting, hit the starter, the yellow flag is out. Car does not want to fire right away. They keep hitting the starter. Finally, the engine fires, and Montoya's away. Let's go to Martin Reed.
Christian Fittipaldi under the yellow, ducks into the pits, makes a great stop, and he's already back out.
Well, Montoya picked up an advantage there at the end as Christian Fittipaldi comes out. Picks up an advantage because the yellow flag came out for Mauricio Guzelman right as he killed it into the pits. Now, it didn't slow the field that quickly all that much, but it gave him a slight advantage. There's your teammate sitting by the roadside, Mark Lindell.
Yeah, I don't know what's gone wrong there, but possibly the situation will happen to Montoya by looks of it. Maybe a fuel shortage, but I don't know. When you're on a roll, you're on a roll. Montoya there, luck of the draw, flags come out, gets a good run with the fuel stop even though he had a problem.
So as now under the caution, they're trying to get Mauricio Guzelman in, Michael Andretti and Christian Fittipaldi both in and out of the pits. And we're under caution again. well, we're under the caution. It gives us a chance to show you the result of a hard impact with the wall here. Mark Blundell, you got the collar on. You say Portland. But part of it was that this injury wasn't discovered immediately. Can you tell us about that?
No, unfortunately, it wasn't discovered until 4 or 5 days later. And, you know, we're kind of lucky. It could have been a lot worse, and we could have been in a lot more trouble. But fortunately, we got to some good guys in Scottsdale. They gave us a break, told us what was wrong, and 3 weeks from now, we should be back.
You've been keeping a smile on your face. Is there a lot of discomfort, though?
There's a little bit of discomfort, but, you know, I'm just sorry I'm not in a Motorola car at this point, especially at our home race. It breaks my heart.
What about the nature of other injuries? Everything else okay?
Everything's fine. He had a few more injuries, but over the last 3 weeks, they've gone away, and we'll be back real soon.
And, Paul, I have to point out, always the racer. He's got the sponsor right where it needs to be.
Yeah. Well, Al Unser Jr. heads into the pits now. Now, Elio Castroneves has been into the pits. Several others taking advantage of this caution. So here comes a little Al. Greg Moore was in, and they took four turns out of the front wings. That's a major change.
Boy, that thing must have been way loose, Paul, to take that much wing out. It's just it shows you what great car control and what determination Greg Moore has to tough it out and stay out there and go so well.
So still under the caution. Now, don't forget, none of the race for the CART FedEx Championship Series. Just 1 week away, one of my favorites, the Milwaukee Mile to the Miller Lite 225. Extending the distance out just a bit now. That thing can be a whirlwind and often can go green flag all the way. Love it when it does that. Now we're going to show you the full field summary. Under this caution, of course, Michael Andretti is the leader of the race, followed by Paul Tracy and Patrick Carpentier. A couple important points, though, is names like the fellow we mentioned at the top of the order, Juan Montoya, is now one lap down to the rest of the field. Pruitt is the first of the cars in 24th down at the bottom of the field in 15th position for the Pruitt car. But I'll tell you what, to see Montoya lap down. Now, during that last caution or during the last break that we had, Pappas, Vasser, P.J. Jones, Tony Kanaan, and Cristiano D'Amato all stopped. So we still have cars a little bit out of order. And we mentioned that Adrian Fernandez had a problem. And as a result of that problem, which included brushing but not injuring a crew member, he's going to get a stop-and-go penalty.
And, Paul, right now with the different pit strategies that the teams are employing, it's really going to be tough to keep track of who's going to get where under what yellow conditions to get to the checkered flag. But right now, Michael Andretti, right up until this last yellow, was the fastest car on the track consistently. Michael, at the beginning of this weekend, said, look, I've got to qualify better because we've had a great car so many races, but I've started so far back. The field is so competitive, I just can't get far enough forward in enough time to win a race. And now Michael's been able to do that. He started a little farther up, certainly disappointed with his qualifying effort, but still he's been able to make the best out of the situation, and now he's leading this race. Paul Tracy, so strong here, very, very determined. And Patrick Carpentier turned in a great qualifying effort with a car that was extremely loose right on the edge. And now here he is in the top three.
That's Christian. He's back running in sixth. Bright yellow helmet there. Nine cars in the lead pack. Five more on the tail end of the lead pack as the green flag comes out for Michael Andretti. Now they're intervening cars, but that green and white car, that's Paul Tracy as he tries to make a move. Comes inside Alex Barron, takes Barron. Look at this, all three wide, and there's trouble. Ryan Herta gets tagged, and he's into the wall. And that's Carpentier, of course. Carpentier, who was running third, and he gets together with Brian Herta as they come back to green. At that section of the track apparently is not three vehicles wide.
Well, and they had a big traffic jam, and as they crossed from the inside and the outside, they just ran into a territorial dispute. And unfortunately, it's one of those situations where you can't get that big of a car going that fast into such a small area.
Now keep an eye on the blue car there. Boy, he just gets slammed off.
And it was one of those situations, Paul, where I think Brian got squeezed from the two cars going past him. He backed off, and what happened is that they just made wheel-to-wheel contact. Carpentier hard on the brakes as Brian Herta got out of the throttle there. No place to go, and they're into the fence.
Yeah, Brian Herta running a lap down just got caught up by everybody battling for the front of the field, Montoya to the outside.
And that's what happened as Montoya went around the outside, Franchitti went around the inside, Carpante with a great run. Brian Herta came way out of, well, he was on the brakes, to be honest with you, Paul, just trying to give those guys some room as they sandwiched him. And Carpante, with all that speed on the way in, as Brian backed out of it, collected him. And he was, as we could see, Patrick was hard on the brakes trying to avoid it, but there was just nothing he could do at that point.
So that quick, we are back to caution again at the Motorola 300. Michael Andretti still stays as the leader. We'll be back after this message and a word from your ABC station.
You're watching ABC's Wide World of Sports.
This Toyota Spotlight focuses on another type of aerodynamics, that of a fastball. On Wednesday, Richie Hearn went to Busch Stadium and got a lesson on pitching from San Francisco Giants pitcher Russ Ortiz.
Right here. Okay. Four-seam is basically straight, and you see the rising fastball.
Yeah. So what's your favorite?
Probably fastball slider. And I have a change.
Ortiz's fastball averages from 92 to 95 miles an hour and has been clocked as fast as 97. Now the view down on Gateway International from the Honda Helicam off to the left there. That one grandstand is under construction. 16,000 new seats as soon as they get it done. Pretty close. They kind of hope to get it done for this race, but it will be open a little bit later this year as the ongoing construction continues. Here are the cautions that we have had, some of them throughout the day, the most recent. Boy, take a look at that. Montoya, they all turned Herta into a sandwich and got him up in the wall. He climbed out of the car, and we have initially good reports on everybody. One of the drivers we're looking for an update on is Robbie Gordon. Marty Reed?
Yes, and it's the right calf, and he showed me the bruise, and Robbie's got a very bad bruise. I guess the big question is, obviously you're okay, but are you going to be okay enough to drive tomorrow and push that go pedal?
I think so. I drove the golf cart back from the hospital, from the infield hospital. So, right ankle seems to be working okay. Calf's definitely sore. Really concerned what happened. I mean, I know what happened. I mean, obviously the car spun out, but car was really good, just starting to come into its own. And before I even turned in turn three, it was headed backwards. So, I don't know if we cut down a tire or broke something in the suspension or something happened, but. It's unfortunate because we had a good car today. We've had a good car all weekend. We thought we could have had a good performance here. On the other hand, I know we have a good race car over at the Speedway. I'm very fortunate that we didn't get hurt in this incident. And hopefully we can do all of our sponsors, Johns Manville, Panasonic, Duracell, and John Menard, a lot of good fortune over there at the 500. You know, we just hope that we can win that deal.
Only Robbie Gordon. Let me ask you something. One of the things that we noticed about the restraints on the front tires, they did the job. What was, from your perspective, what did you see after the crash was over?
Tires are both laying there together. That's one thing good. The tires were connected to the car. Didn't seem like it hurt our crash anymore because the tires being connected to the car. So I think it could be a good thing in the future.
I do get a kick out of this, though, Paul. He's the only guy I know that can equate driving the golf cart back with saying, okay, I can now go 225 at Indy.
There's a man who is always racing. Robbie Gordon out, and the good news is that he is okay except for that bruise. The showdown at Sherwood is what they call it. David Duval and Tiger Woods on Monday, August 2nd, live at 8 p.m. on ABC Sports. We're still under yellow. We'll be back with more. The Motorola 300 still under caution. Seven different leaders today. Montoya, Moreno, Hunter Jr., Paul Tracy, Patrick Carpentier, Greg Moore, and Michael Andretti. Let's go to Marty Reed.
Yes, and Paul, what's left of the number eight just went by, and it's got to be heartsick because it wasn't your fault. You had nowhere to go, didn't you?
No. You know, I'm not sure how it all triggered up, you know, those restarts. It's so hard to pass. Everybody's you give them a little bit of an opening, and they're trying something. I saw one of the cool cars, you know, look like dive bombing in on Carpentier, and I don't know, one of those guys hit me and spun me up in the wall. There's nothing I could do, and it's a shame. You know, we weren't great, but we were hoping to hang on and make the car better and, you know, try and get some points today. And just, you know, one thing after another this year, it hasn't been great for us. And you know, we're coming back strong for Milwaukee. I mean, I'm so upset right now, and you know, I just can't wait to get to Milwaukee and put some points up and get to Portland and go win the race.
That's the one great thing about this sport, Paul. There's always next week.
This is an enormous weekend for auto racing fans. Two of the drivers in this race, Robbie Gordon and Roberto Moreno, will be heading over to Indianapolis for the 83rd running of the Indy 500. For an update on the action there, here's Bob Jenkins.
Thanks, Paul. Well, the stage is set for the running of the 83rd 500 on Sunday. It's been an exciting couple of weeks. Ari Leyendijk, of course, will be in his 15th and final and very emotional 500-mile race. Eddie Cheever will be defending his championship. He has changed engines from last year. And, of course, don't forget Tony Stewart. He'll be running here at Indianapolis and then going to Charlotte for the NASCAR Winston Cup race. We'll have the action for you live here at 11 o'clock Eastern Time on ABC. And right now, Paul, that all-important weather forecast looks good.
Thanks, Bob. We're still under the caution here. It will be Michael Andretti, Paul Tracy, Dario Franchitti, Roberto Moreno, and Christian Fittipaldi, the top five. They are still finishing up the end of the cleanup and putting the trucks back on station in the Motorola 300. We'll be back right after this.
This Wide World of Sports update brought to you by Mobile Speed Pass, the fastest way to get gas. It's free and it's only at Mobile.
Well, I believe I was born to race. In fact, my mom raced when she was pregnant with me. Winning. And I truly believe that's my destiny.
Welcome back to St. Louis and Gateway International Raceway at the Motorola 300. I'm Paul Page with Parker Johnstone, Marty Reed, and John Kernan covering in the pits. You can see the safety vehicles are still on the course, though they're starting to work back to station. There's actually quite a bit of oil dry that had to be cleared off the course for Brian Herta's accident. Patrick Carpentier was also involved in that, Marty Reed.
Yes, Paul, we're outside the medical center. Patrick is inside right now. A team official did come out long enough to tell us that he is complaining of stiffness and soreness from his neck down through his shoulders, and that he got banged up pretty good, but they think he's going to be okay. As soon as we get the official word, we'll pass it on.
Thanks, Marty. Unfortunately, that medical center a little more busy today than we had hoped. The field still continuing to circle behind the pace car. PJ Jones and the rest ready to come back out of the race. Tarso Marquez, Robbie Gordon, who you just talked to, Dill DeFerrin is out, Dennis Vitolo, Brian Herta, and Patrick Carpentier, Herta and Carpentier with the accident that started this yellow. Now, indications are next time around, they will get the indication that there is just one lap to take it back to green. We are at the 128th lap, and the crowd from time to time has jumped to their feet. The biggest time was when Al Unser Jr. took the lead. Boy, they were screaming when he came down the front stretch. As we've already indicated, it's been a very busy day. We're going to go through the onboard cameras again for you. But a lot of mixing up here in the midpoint of the race and some good racing.
Some very good racing, Paul. Some of the best we've seen all year. As the drivers prepare to go back to yellow here, they're getting heat in the rear tires. You can see Michael Andretti just did a wheel burn there. A little bit of movement side to side, because one of the key places that you can pass are on these restarts. Everybody's got to be wide awake, paying full attention, and not let the guy in front of them get a jump. And that's what they're trying to do here, is to get a jump on the guy behind them while not losing contact with the guy in front. But great racing, very, very close. That's why we've seen some of the incidents we've seen today.
Now we're going to put in the Kmart telemetry on Michael Andretti as he comes back to the green flag. Pace picks up. Here goes Michael.
Watch how hard it accelerates as it comes down the pit straightaway.
Now, Paul Tracy, the third car in the order, is actually second in the run. Big battle further back on, and here it comes.
Oh,
look at that group. Oh!
That was Montoya, I think, there, Paul, once again. We'll have a look here. I think that was Montoya getting the car sideways again.
Boy, and Fernandez looks like he's in trouble. Montoya was trying to jump out and around Mauricio Guzman at the same time. Christian Fittipaldi was in there doing battle with Moreno, and Adrian Fernandez with a puff of smoke at the back of the car head in. And we don't know if it's because he has a problem or because it's the black flag that he needs to answer. We'll let you know. And officials there, so he's answering the black flag. But that was kind of an ominous puff of smoke at the back of the car. Marty Reed?
Yeah, Paul, you're absolutely right. They had to do the stop-and-go penalty under green. That's what he just did.
Christian Fittipaldi behind Castro Neves almost takes it down into the grass. You're on board with Christian. We're going to ride here for a while. Capaldi, but Greg Moore right there behind him. And then Max Pappas and T.J. Jones. Here comes Pappas. Pappas inside Moore. Whoa, close through the corner. They hang on side by side. Boy, Moore really fought back on that one.
Paul, that's the first time I've been able to see a driver drive all the way around the outside of turns one and two without getting far enough up into the gray to lose control of the car. And look at the gap he starts to pull on Max Pappas. That was some bravery there by Greg Moore on the outside of turns one and two.
P.J. Jones right behind that. Pappas comes out, gets some clean air, takes a look down into the corner. This breaks off. We go forward to the battle for second place. Paul Tracy is now battling with Frank Heedy. So here's an intra-team rivalry. Now remember, when you see Montoya in the shot, he's well back in this field now. A lap behind the race in 15th position.
And Paul, I can't express how difficult it is to catch a car when it's down on the rumble strips the way that we saw Montoya catch it just a few laps ago. Once a car is on those rumble strips, it's nearly impossible to catch it, but he did.
Montoya trying to work his way back through the field. Shows once again his power. Out and around Franchitti, now Montoya taking a look at second place Tracy. Well, if the caution periods would go right, Montoya could conceivably get back on the lead lap.
You know, I don't think Montoya knows well enough that he's a lap down and that his race is over. He's fighting very hard to catch Paul Tracy and then go after Michael Andretti to get back on the lead lap. In his mind, he thinks he's still in this, and it's exactly that kind of attitude that got Zanardi to the front so many times when he was so far behind. He races no matter whether he's in first place or if he's back in 15th, a lap down. We saw Zanardi do it at Long Beach, and now here's Montoya trying to work his way back up on the lead lap.
The Hogan car, the 9 car, Helio Castroneves. He is currently fifth, Christian Fittipaldi. Now beginning to work on him while Greg Moore closes on Fittipaldi. You ride with Christian. And Christian is still pumped after his podium finish 2 weeks ago at Rio and his pole position, first of his career.
Another unusual oval, Paul, where they're downshifting in both corners, both going into turn one and turn three. We'll see him go down two gears as he gets hard on the brakes here, coming down from 205 miles to 145.
Kmart telemetry on Christian Fittipaldi.
Up to fifth gear, up to six. Once again, almost 210 miles an hour there. Pulling four G's through this long egg-shaped corner. It's an egg-shaped oval. This is the broader, the longer of the two corners.
In sixth place, but closing on Helio Castroneves.
You can see how smooth he is, Paul. Very, very gentle with the wheel. Any motion that you see there is feedback from the bumps on the track coming back through the steering system back to the wheel. You can see the big bumps on the entry of three there, smaller bumps coming through four, and one bump here right under the bridge.
Now there gives you a good idea on how Christian Fittipaldi has closed up on Helio Castroneves. Same time, Moore closes on Fittipaldi. Andretti is 3.2 seconds ahead of second place for Paul Tracy. Then Franchitti, then Marino, and then this battle. Though Alex Barron, there in the Dan Gurney Eagle, been holding his own even though he's a lap down, just ahead of Helio Castroneves. Two laps complete, 236 is scheduled distance with 93 to go.
Paul, as we ride along with Michael Andretti and PJ Jones, watch the difference in their helmet positions as they go through the corners. Now we'll see that PJ Jones lets his head lean out a lot more to the outside. Remember, they're pulling almost four G's here. Watch the tilt as he gets to the corner. Watch how it comes to the outside.
Michael Andretti's helmet, on the other hand, is very firmly held in place, so you'll see his head stays very, very level as he enters the corners. Now, a lot of the teams also not only tilt the helmets of the drivers to the inside, but also the seats. They're tilted 3, 4, 5 degrees towards the inside on the banking, so the drivers don't feel like they're falling off to the outside. Very, very important. But PJ Jones, he doesn't seem to mind having his head off center here to the outside. You can see how it goes out to the left side there. The net effect is it makes it seem like you're trying to go off or fall off the outside.
Yeah, pretty cool, Parker.
Great shots there. And you can see that even though it's an oval, the drivers are getting shaken around a great deal. Someone told me once that the secret to setting the Renard up is to get it so stiff that the driver's butt stipe starts to get hot, and so stiff that they can barely see. Now, we were riding along with two Swifts. You can see there's still a lot of motion there. It's very, very difficult to see. Very hot in the cockpits. It can reach temperatures of 135 degrees. A very difficult environment to work in.
Oh, I love that techie stuff, especially the heat in the undertray part. Roberto Moreno still staying in this fight in fourth place, Marty Reid.
Yeah,
oh, take a look at this. Montoya trying to get up through the field, now makes his move on Tracy, and that brings Franchitti in contact with Tracy. Franchitti comes way down on the inside to battle with Paul Tracy. Let's not forget last year. Here it is again. Franchitti and Tracy get together. Second and third place, both in trouble.
A repeat.
But Franchitti is able to get it going again.
And I tell you, that was some great car control by Dario Franchitti. That, what he did, is nearly impossible to keep the car going around the same arc of the corner. It was brilliant, but boy, I'm glad I'm not on the headset with Barry Green right now, Paul.
Oh, man, I was just thinking, I was about to say, don't forget Houston last year where the two of them got together. And
or St. Louis last year, for that fact, on the first lap going into turns three.
Here were the two of them battling.
You can see Dario is as low as he possibly can go, Paul. Paul Tracy tried to take him down to the inside. Dario held his ground. Paul started to squeeze him. And trust me, you can't get on those rumple strips without serious consequences. And unfortunately, they made contact. Paul Tracy making heavy contact with the outside wall.
Oh, but a nice bit of a save for Franchitti. Wow.
Now, you can see Dario moved up just a little bit, but when you're that low on the paint, the car will naturally wash up. He came up maybe a foot, but there just wasn't racing room to go through there side by side because Paul had left him no additional room.
You want to assign a fault there, Parker?
No, Paul, not at all.
Not to put you on the spot or anything.
Well, I tell you, it's one of those things. We saw it with Carpentier and Michael Andretti at Milwaukee. We've seen it in the past. We managed to see just earlier Greg Moore and Max Pappas get away with it, but as we see it, looks like Tracy just tried to stay as low as possible. Franchitti came up just a little bit. And when you're running that close at open-wheel cars, an inch is sometimes just too much, Paul.
Paul Tracy's second DNF this year as a result of an accident. Remember his incident at Long Beach. So Paul Tracy was running up in the top three, as was his teammate, and they're out. We'll be back after this message and a word from your ABC station.
Watching ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Sunday, May 30th, 3:30 Eastern Time, Sports Century presented by General Motors. Babe Ruth, Mickey Mantle, Joe DiMaggio, all the features on Sports Century as they look at sports dynasties. Well, while we were away, several came into the pits, included among them Dario Franchitti. In what appeared to be a routine stop, with the stops, Elio Castroneves took the lead by Christian Fittipaldi and Greg Moore. Let's go to John Kernan.
And I'm with Barry Green. Barry, first of all, Paul okay, and then Dario came in and pitted. Is his car okay?
Yeah, Paul never spoke to us, but we saw him on the TV there jump straight out, so I think he's okay. Dario's okay. Everything seems okay. Of course, we won't know until we get back to speed again, but he came in and precautionary stop. They're still in eighth place and a long way to go, so he's looking pretty good. It's one of those racing incidents, you know. I mean, the two of them got together, just touched. It wasn't a big hit, but I think Paul probably thought Dario had backed off and Dario was sort of trying to get out of there, but was too committed, and just one of those deals, really. But it's too bad because they're both running well, and I think it was summing up. It was looking like it was going to be a great finish here. But we still got one in there and running strong.
Dario, before he pitted, had complained about a vibration, so that's why they decided to come on in and change all four tires. We'll have to wait and see if his car is okay once they get back up to speed.
And I bet he had a big vibration, Paul, because those tires were probably flat-spotted square by the time he got through sliding that car through turns 3 and 4.
Well, it was the 148th lap. You know, if you operate under the premise that the responsibility for the pass lies with the overtaking car, then that gives you an entirely different look. I think Barry Green's analysis of the whole thing was probably the best.
I think so, too, Paul. It's one of those things. Dario had no place to back out of. Paul was assuming that Dario would. And I tell you, when you get a run on someone like that after Paul had gotten bottled neck in traffic, you have to just go for it. And that's what happens when you go racing.
Well, let's try this out. Scott Pruitt, Alex Barron, and Juan Montoya all got back onto the lead lap with that yellow. So, once again, Montoya may be back into the fight. We'll be back. And our Toyota Spotlight focuses on the magnificent rookie, Juan Montoya. At Long Beach, brilliant run. He is, in fact, the man and takes his first victory. And then he turned around and did the same thing at Nazareth and then 2 weeks ago at Rio. Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, and Juan Montoya makes the podium as the top guy once again. Three in a row, looking for four today. Starts on the pole, but the day doesn't look nearly as strong as he drops a lap behind the lead, but with all the movement in the past couple of yellows, he is back on the lead lap. And he is going to be something to watch when they go back to green flag. Let's look at some percentages of winning. This is all time. Juan Montoya. Of course, you know that the numbers are smaller with just those few starts, but still very, very impressive. Ready to go green again. Helio Castroneves. We're going to watch Montoya up in the box so we can keep track of the lead and Montoya. Castroneves, Fittipaldi, Moore, Cristiano D'Amato, Jimmy Vassar. Top five, they're all in contact. Tony Kanaan is up there in sixth place and steadily coming up through the field. Montoya moves on Al Unser Jr.
Like we said a little earlier, he just doesn't know any better, Paul. He thinks he can still win this race, and that's exactly the mentality you need. He's coming through traffic very, very fast.
Now watching Jess Montoya. Round through it, Al Unser Jr. to 12th. P.J. Jones just ahead of him. That's 11th. Marty Reid.
Paul, we're down here with Adrian Fernandez, who's out of this race now. You were up to 6. What put you out?
Well, first, we had some problems with the clutch. It was slipping, and that's how we had these problems in our pit. And then we have an oil leak, so it was unfortunate because we were running really strong, and we were looking for a top 5, top 4. The car was free.
Montoya gets way high. I'm sorry, Marty. Montoya tried to move on PJ, got way up, saved it, and back in. Go ahead, Marty. I'm sorry.
Tell you the truth, Adrian saw the same thing. He's watching the big screen. He was about ready to go wow, too.
Well, Montoya starts to make that move. Sorry to see Adrian Fernandez out of the race. Montoya starts that move on Adrian's teammate, PJ Jones. Goes way up. Once again, a save with very quick hands that normally you would not see.
You know what's amazing, Paul, is he had a good run on PJ. He had plenty of room around the outside, and then he just flat couldn't get the car down around the outside of PJ down to the inside of the corner. But boy, is he good. He slid that car all the way around the top side. For most drivers, that would have been a wreck. And if nothing else, that would have put a dent into their confidence. But here's Montoya saying, all right, I'm back together again. I've got a run on PJ. I'm going to try this again.
Nothing changes at the front. We're going to look at it one more time to show you how totally far Montoya was offline.
But he's got a great run on him, Paul. He's got plenty of room to get into the corner. But as he turns in hard, the back end started to step out. He had to drive it to the outside to keep it under control. And yet, now here he comes again.
Montoya looking at PJ once again. Now he's going to try it on the outside. Very, very close. Watch those wheels. Gets past. And Montoya comes further forward, John Kernan.
And Paul, the funny thing was, right after he made that mistake and then saved the car, he radioed and told the crew, "I'm sorry about that, guys." And Chip Ganassi radioed back and said, "Hey, that's all right. You saved it."
That is a very nifty piece of driving by Montoya. Nothing changes at the front. Castro Neves, Fittipaldi, Moore, D'Amata, Vassar. Mauricio Guzman slows down, pulls off of the course, no yellow.
And Paul, I think the only way I can describe that is imagine going 65 miles an hour down the highway and just out of nowhere on a beautiful day hitting black ice. Well, these guys are prepared for such incidents, but the car control that he exhibited was phenomenal.
Here's Cristiano D'Amata, Toyota Power, having a terrific day once again, setting up in fourth place.
He is another young driver with great car control, very, very mature, very smart, and another great run for this MCI WorldCom car. R. Cyril Wells working extremely hard, Paul, to become one of the front runners, and they're doing it. They're doing it a little bit at a time. They had the all-time highest place Toyota finish at Nazareth with the fourth, and here they're capitalizing on great pit work and smart driving and strategy with Cristiano D'Amata.
This is Jimmy Vassar. He's in fifth place behind D'Amata. Tony Kanaan is behind Jimmy. Montoya, he got high once again just a second ago. That short interval while we were watching Jimmy Vassar. Look at this. How
wow.
does he do it?
Paul, you know, you've only got so many lives, and when you use them up, you use them up. But what's happening there, I think, going down into turn one, he's pulling the car down really fast right on the entry, and when he does it, it's rotating the back, combined with the fact that he was running in the turbulence of Max Pappas in front of him. But still, it doesn't shake him at all. Most people would be hospitalized with cardiac arrest after doing that one time. He does it lap after lap after lap.
Back to fifth place in Jimmy Vassar. D'Amata ahead, Kanaan just behind. Tony Kanaan, who had fallen back, but has just been steadily working his way forward.
And Tony had the biggest crash of his young career here last year and said that he was a little gun-shy coming back to St. Louis, but yet, through just very, very slow, thought-out progress, they've chipped away, kept on the lead lap, and now Tony's running very, very strongly in fifth place.
Montoya has about a second of time to make up if he's going to close on 10th place Max Pappas. So for the moment, he has just freewheeling to try and catch Pappas. We'll stay here with Vassar, watch Vassar and Kanaan, and also we'll keep an eye on Cristiano D'Amata.
And Paul, as we get down to the later stages of the race, the pace has really picked up. With the exception of just a couple of cars in the early going, everybody else was in the 27-second range, only a couple cars in the very high 26s, 26.9s, 26.8s. But now, first five, six, seven cars are all running in the 26s, being led by Elio Castroneves, who's running 26.4s, 26.5s. So clearly a half a second quicker than the early pace. They're pushing very, very hard, trying to sprint to that last pit stop that'll get them to the checkered flag.
There's the leader, Elio Castroneves. He is carrying the emblems of all the St. Louis professional sports teams on the side of the car. Of course, hometown team for Carl Hogan, the owner. Marty, you've been watching from that pit.
I'll tell you what, Paul, everybody's within, as far as the lead cars are concerned, their pit window for one more stop. But if it stays green, we think that Castroneves can go to about 190, lap 190, before they are going to have to stop for fuel. And remember what happened in this race last year. It was the last pit stop that decided who won the contest.
Well, Elio last stopped on the 109th lap. Of course, the assumption, almost the obvious assumption, is everyone is going to have to stop at least one more time. Second place, 6 seconds back from Castroneves, is Christian Fittipaldi, John Kernan.
And right now, Christian is looking at pitting in about 15 laps or so, the high 180s, I'm being told. The problem that Christian has, he hasn't had radio communication with the team since the start of the race, although every once in a while, one of the crewmen is able to get a response from Christian on the radio. But they say they can't count on that. They're hoping that they can get Christian the message of when to stop, so he doesn't run out of fuel out there on the racetrack. But Fittipaldi with some radio problems, hoping that doesn't throw a kink into his plans to pick up his first career victory.
Well, we may not have two-way radio with him, but we do have the Kmart telemetry. So we'll watch it for second place, Christian Fittipaldi. And don't worry, we're keeping track of Montoya as he closes on Mac Pappas.
And speaking of Montoya, Paul, he's about due for a pit stop, so he's praying that a yellow comes out so he can remain on that lead lap. But you can see way off in the distance, Elio Castroneves continuing to be 2/3 of a second a lap quicker than anybody else. This is Christian now approaching a lap car. This isn't the leader. And what he's doing is he's extending now 2/3 of a second a lap. Now he's just over 6 seconds in front of Christian Fittipaldi.
Here's Juan Montoya as he starts to work on Max Pappas. This is the fight for 10th place. Christian Fittipaldi, by the way, have completed every race lap available thus far this year.
And Paul, as we start to get close to this next round of pit stops, it's obviously the most crucial pit stop of the race. Not only putting the onus on the teams to do great, quick, precise work to try to keep their drivers in at least the same position or game positions, but the drivers have to make the final determination of what they need from their crews as far as tire pressures, rear stagger, and wing adjustments to try to put these cars as close to the razor knife edge as they can get. These cars have to be almost evenly balanced in order to make them as fast as possible for the sprint to the checkered flag.
The RCRO Wells car of Scott Pruitt was 15th into the pits, routine service. Montoya, the battle for 10th continues. No real contest at the moment in the top of the order, though Greg Moore is from time to time beginning to take a look at Fittipaldi. Still not in attack position. Pruitt completes his stop and is back out. Montoya in the draft now begins to pick up some of the momentum off of Pappas. Parker and I had breakfast with the Rahal team, Pappas, Brian Herta, Bobby Rahal. Bobby seems very comfortable in his role. Here's Greg Moore. Bobby Rahal in his role as an owner this year. Puts that great driving career behind him. Now looking to win races, win championships as an owner. Take a look at this. The fastest laps of the day. 10 fast laps. All the same guy. The Lola. Helio Castroneves.
He's on fire, Paul. We've seen this all on all the ovals so far this year. It's just bad luck, timing, some things have gone wrong that have kept this Hogan Racing team from capitalizing on this extremely talented young man in this Lola chassis. With it. And trust me, they're testing, they're working very hard, they've got a good budget, but still it's a David and Goliath story. And I mean, this kid is driving the wheels off this car, and every lap he goes faster and faster.
And look at the interval back to second place. Christian Fittipaldi in the black car, yellow helmet, that's Christian. Greg Moore is just behind him, but it's a full 5 seconds, which here is a full straightaway.
Actually, that interval's closed as Elio has gotten close to lap traffic. He's lost some of the momentum. He's lost almost a second and a half of the lead that he had built over Christian Fittipaldi. The key here is on any of these ovals, Paul, when you catch lap traffic, you can't hesitate. You have to be very decisive. Use your additional speed and momentum to get around them. If you get blocked up, you can spend laps trying to regain that advantage to try to make a pass stick.
And on the Montoya watch, he's kind of stuck in 11th. Mac Pappas has pulled away actually a little bit, and the interval remains the same now between Pappas and Montoya. So keeping an eye on the leader of the race, he could be due in any time. At the same time, here comes Montoya.
Well, as neutral to oversteering as this car is, Paul, I doubt if we'll see very many changes, at least obvious changes at the front of the car. Oh.
Well, and Cristiano D'Amata has a problem. Looks like the engine let go. The yellow comes out as Montoya heads toward John Kernan.
Juan Montoya is in a four-tire change. We expect him to go half up on the wings. Wayne Westblake to left front, Rob Hill right front tire, Ricky Davis left rear, Simon Hodgson the right rear. They're waiting for it to be full of fuel, and there he goes down to lane 12.3 seconds for Montoya.
And Montoya picks up the advantage, or at least the beginning of the advantage, of the fact that the yellow flag came out while he was about halfway down the road. The yellow came out for Cristiano D'Amata.
Well, this is the second time this race this has happened. And Blundell, when he was visiting with us, Mark said, how come this guy is so lucky? And I want to ask the same question. He is truly blessed, because to be put in such a disadvantage position and then both times to have the yellow come out as you come onto the pit road is phenomenal luck.
Lucky and good is an awesome combination. So the field slows. 187 laps are complete. 236 the distance here. The look down on the gateway course here from the Honda Helicam. 1.27 miles around, but you can see the shape is what makes it so challenging with that tight first turn, forcing them to downshift sometimes as far as three gears, heavy on the brakes, and it's also gobbled up a few cars today.
It has, and we've been on nothing but unusual ovals, whether it's Nazareth, whether it's Motegi, you know, down at Rio. A traditional oval like Milwaukee, for example, where you've got two corners that are almost identical, two straightaways which are the same length, banking that's the same, where normally you're just feathering off the throttle and then adding throttle back on, maybe some left foot braking depending on traffic and how much speed you're carrying. But all the ovals we've been on to date are almost rovals. And this is, even though it looks like a traditional oval, it's very unusual for the champ cars to be on the brakes and downshifting. And we're seeing a lot of that again today here at Gateway.
And next Sunday, of course, we will be at Milwaukee with the coverage on ABC, one of the great ovals in the series. The field now caught to the pace car. But here comes the front of the order beginning to peel off. Castro Neves, Fittipaldi, Greg Moore, they all head for the pits. Actually expect everybody on the lead lap. Vasser, Kanaan, they are all heading in. So as Castro Neves leads the field down, let's go to Marty Reid.
Last year, this race was decided on the final pit stop. Michael Andretti led 133 laps. He ended up losing a full second in the pits, and it was the difference. They pulled to a stop. The clocks are running. There will be no wing adjustment. He likes the car, as you saw by those fast laps. The clock is still running. Fuel is what is essential. They got to make it to the end. He's up to 10 seconds. 11, 12, he's out of here. John Turner.
And the first car out is Michael Andretti. Is a little bit of a slow stop for Lucian Fittipaldi. But Michael, they made a wing adjustment, and they got the four tires changed, the fuel, and sent Michael Andretti back out. He beat, I believe, everybody else off of pit road, if I could see that.
Oh, you bet he did. Michael Andretti came roaring out of there. The teams all working against the clock and against one another. But Michael Andretti and the Newman Haas team with a nice stop puts Michael in the lead of the race, came into the pits in fifth, and comes up out in front. There's downtown St. Louis, just across the Mississippi River. We're under caution. The leaders have completed what should be their final stop. We'll be back. Tomorrow on ABC, coverage of the greatest spectacle in racing, the Indianapolis 500. Ari Leyendijk in his last race takes him on from the pole. Can he win the last race of his career? For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network, go.com. So with that last set of stops, which theoretically at the end of the day, look at how it changed everything. Michael to first, Moreno ninth up to second, Jones 10th to third. And Marty Reid, you say there may be some dispute, not involving those three cars, but somebody else.
Well, yes, Paul, the nine car, Helio Castroneves, has called into the team saying, hey, I think Franchitti passed under the yellow. What thing I wanted to throw to Parker was, what about the amount of fuel? Because look at what happened with the 20 car. They moved up to third by taking only 10 gallons, and we're back to green racing.
Green flag comes out. That's Max Pappas making the move down the inside on P.J. Jones. Side by side now is Franchitti down inside of P.J. Jones. Helio Castroneves just behind him. And Greg Moore. Michael Andretti is the leader.
We saw Dario all the way down on the rumble strips again. It was almost an exact duplicate of the incident with Paul Tracy a little earlier.
Oh, man, look at this. Look at this as Castroneves pokes his nose right in there and stays. So Castroneves, if there was an argument about Franchitti, it's over now. And now Castroneves taking a look at P.J. Jones. That battle is for fourth. Andretti, Moreno, Max Pappas. 1, 2, 3.
This is the Saturday night main event. This is the sprint, Paul.
Castroneves makes a move on P.J. Jones, and he gets him. Boy, Castroneves is flying.
He liked the view before the round of pit stops, Paul, and I think he wants to get it back. He is driving an incredible race. He is just diving in without any consequence, saving it somewhere in between and driving it off the corner.
Franchitti gets high as he makes a try on PJ Jones. Moore is right there. Now Tony Kanaan closes in. This is a battle for fifth place. Look at Moore. Up high, loses a little momentum. They come off at turn four, down the front stretch. A second out in front, it's Michael Andretti, then Roberto Moreno, then Max Pappas. And then this battle. Castro Neves, now you see him. He closes in on Max Pappas. Laps toward the end, beginning to roll off now. Michael Andretti, Roberto Moreno, that's the red and blue car, subbing for Mark Blundell. Sits in second place. Castro Neves works on Max Pappas.
And Paul, right now, the drivers have the cars balanced exactly the way they want to, right on the razor's edge. Fuel is not a concern. They're at full power, full revs. The only people that are nervous are the data acquisition techs down in the pits, because they're the ones who calculated how long to leave the fuel nozzles in to get just enough fuel in to get to the checkered flag. They didn't need a fuel load. They only need enough to get to lap 236.
Castro Neves tries it on Max Pappas. He is passed. Castro Neves moves to third. Franchitti is still taking a hard look at PJ Jones for fifth place. See up there at the top of the screen? Here comes Franchitti, though. Jones seems to be able to hold him off, and Moore and the blue cars drop back. Franchitti again, that high entry into the corner.
And he's looking, Paul. He just can't find a way around him. The aerodynamic turbulence created by PJ Swift is not allowing Dario to use the advantage that he has, which is right here coming through turns three and four. Dario can get a good run coming off the corner, but he can't utilize that advantage coming down the straightaway. This is his opportunity right here.
Michael Andretti, 1.3 out in front of Roberto Moreno. This is where the battle is right now.
Dario is continuing to try to figure out how to use that mid-cornering speed advantage. And what he has to do is actually back off a little bit, Paul, then get the run coming through the middle of the corner so he doesn't get held up, and then use it to draft down the inside.
Consider the top five. It's starting. We'd indicated how many guys who have not won are hoping to do so here today. Andretti is one. Moreno, Castro Neves, Pappas, and Jones, second, third, fourth, and fifth, have never won in the series.
Elio Castro Neves is now 2 to 3 tenths of a second quicker than anybody else on the racetrack, Paul. And he's closing down that gap to Michael. Just a few laps ago, it was 2.5 seconds. Now it's just 1.7 seconds. He's obviously quicker than Moreno. If he gets by, then he'll hunt down Michael.
Castro Neves tucks in, picks up the toe from Moreno, moves to the inside. Boy, that looked very, very easy. This kid is fast. Now we're going to take a look at the line as they come to cross. Here comes Michael. Castro Neves. Moreno. As suspected, Castro Neves quick that last lap.
A mile and a half an hour faster, Paul, and his move was perfectly timed. They went right down to the section where you're going to lift off or even use a little brakes, and Elio just stuck the car down the inside and then dealt with the problem of how to get the car through the corner once he had made the pass. Excellently timed, great move by Castro Neves.
Elio Castro Neves coming out of the Indy Lights series.
And Paul, on that last lap, Castro Neves just went 6 tenths of a second quicker than Michael Andretti. He is by far the fastest car on the racetrack by a huge margin.
Now Franchitti and Moore working on P.J. Jones. That's the battle for fifth. There's Jones, there's Franchitti, and Moore just behind him. You ride with Jones. Franchitti comes to the inside, and he blows past P.J. Jones. P.J. gets way up high. Moore almost gets him.
Another great example of car control. PJ had the back end step out up in the marbles, and he was able to hang on to it.
So now PJ Jones has to hold off Greg Moore.
And Paul, if these cars get more than about 10 to 20 degrees sideways, they lose all the flow through the bottom of the car, where most of the downforce is produced, and these things turn into roller skates at 200 miles an hour. These guys are exhibiting tremendous car control, tremendous ability.
And look at how the lead is narrowed down. Castro Neves is now 4 tenths, well, closer than that, behind Michael Andretti. He's right there. He's in the tow. John Kernan.
Michael Andretti just asked his crew on the radio, is Helio going to have to pit? They've told Michael, no, you two are racing for position to the end. Do the best you can. Keep it on slot 4. But Michael was thinking that possibly Helio would have to pit and he could let him go by. But now look for Andretti to make it a lot tougher for Castro Neves to pass him.
Castro Neves, new to the series. Michael Andretti, one of the great veterans of the series. What an interesting battle this will be.
Catching Michael is one thing, Paul. Passing him is something else. That's probably the news Michael didn't want to hear. But you can see how the interval has dropped over just the last handful of laps. Castro Neves now trying to figure out a way, now that he's caught the leader, how do I use my advantage to get around him? And Michael obviously has now also picked up the pace. They're both running identical lap times. And remember, Michael just a number of years ago at Phoenix thought he had the lead, thought he had the race win, and didn't realize that the pass at the very end was for the race win. He's never going to let that happen again. Helio Castroneves has got his work cut out from a very determined Michael Andretti.
Michael Andretti with 236 starts. Castroneves with 25. Catching Michael Andretti is one thing. Passing Michael Andretti, that's entirely different.
Michael's car is handling very, very well. It's very stable, very predictable. Michael can place it low on the racetrack, which is where he likes to drive. As we watch, you can see he's right down on the white line. Helio a little bit higher. He's up a little higher, Paul, for a couple of reasons. First of all, he's trying to find some clean air on the high side of Michael to get through the front of that Lola, over the front wings and down into the undertray. Also, I think Castro Neves' car is maybe running a little looser than Michael's, so he's going to take that higher line. And remember, it's only a few feet. We aren't talking 6, 8, 10 feet. But a few feet make a big difference with these cars.
Got a glimpse of Dada there. Mario Andretti watching his son. 25 to go now. And barring a yellow flag, we will stay with the coverage right to the checker.
And that was great as he came off of turn 4. You can see Michael check his outside mirror. He's keeping track.
Making the move now on Pappas. Franchitti comes inside. Franchitti to 4th. His next target will be Moreno.
He got in there very deep under the brakes. You can see how high he washed up. But Dario held on to it, was able to maintain some momentum cutting off the exit. Max trying to utilize his lower line through the corner, but he couldn't get back at Dario and retake that position.
Now Greg Moore begins to take a look at Pappas. We'll go back to the front of the field. Castro Neves still working on Michael Andretti. And Alex Baron, a fire at the back end, looks like something let go and started a small oil fire. It still burns. He wisely got it off the race course and does not bring out a yellow, at least not yet. Officials will no doubt determine if that is a perilous position and whether or not they will have to go yellow to get the car out of there. But thus far, they've stayed green. 214 complete.
Castro Neves was running almost a half a second quicker than his current pace, but what's happened is that he's caught up to Michael. He hasn't been able to figure out where to drop back, where to accelerate. Paul, at this point, instead of just running in the same distance, 3, 4 car lengths, 5 car lengths, we're in the middle of the buffeting. Helio almost needs to drop back, regather his wits about him, and then make another charge on Michael to try to see if he can't use the momentum to get by. Otherwise, he's going to be stuck here for the rest of the race.
They're beginning to catch traffic just ahead, though. Marty Reid.
Well, there's nothing on the radio. The last call was from Carl Hogan telling him he had 25 laps to go. He is not saying anything, but watching from down here as he goes by and through the corners on the big monitors, it looks like it may be a situation where dirty air and the fact that Michael's doing a better job and laying down some quicker lap times.
They're closing very quickly on Shigeaki Hattori.
And Paul, that's really Elio's only chance right now is lap traffic. If Michael hits it just wrong and he hits it just right, he'll be able to get by. But I can tell you right now, Elio's quicker. He just can't get around him.
John Kernan.
Michael Andretti's crew has just told him to go to slot five, and I would assume that's full fuel, and he is good to go the rest of the way, and we'll have to see now if he picks up a little more speed.
The Kmart telemetry for Michael Andretti. The first set of bumps, a little rough through there.
Watch how fast the fence goes by on the upper left-hand side of the screen, Paul. That gives you an idea of just how fast these guys are going as he gets by Hattori.
Yeah, both Castroneves and Andretti cleanly passed Hattori. Now, you got to give credit to Roberto Moreno, who sits there in third place. He's just behind Hattori now. Franchitti is beginning to take a hard look at him, but Roberto has driven a brilliant race today.
And Paul, the guy that's turning the race's quickest laps right now is that man right there, Dario.
Franchitti moves on Roberto Moreno, and he takes over third place.
Dario is now starting to match the lap times that Elio was turning about 15 laps ago. He's down in the mid-26-second range, and he's trying to take advantage of the situation of Castroneves and Michael being stuck at 27 seconds flat, which is the range they're running right now. But he's catching him about a half a second a lap.
Franchitti and Moreno both get around Shigeaki Hattori. And the fight is back here at the front.
Paul, I know it sounds silly, but once again, the only hope Castroneves has here is actually to drop back a little bit and then take another run at Michael. Otherwise, he's going to be right in the same position. And the worst thing that's going to happen is that Dario Franchitti will use his momentum and the fact that these two guys are bogged down and go right past Castroneves and then set his sights on Michael. With the amount of lap time now, Dario turns a quick lap at 26.3 seconds. He's got enough laps left to get the job done. Castroneves better figure out how to get past Michael Andretti if he's looking for it. His first win for Hogan Racing.
With 13 to go, we'll keep an eye on the lead, but we wanted to take you back here as Tony Kanaan is beginning to work on seventh place PJ Jones. There's Fittipaldi right behind him. Then Jimmy Vassar, Unser Jr., and Montoya. They're all in this fight. Six different guys battling. Upstream and wait for the leaders to come through. Here is Michael. Castroneves still locked in that same position. But Franchitti, he's inching forward.
That last lap, both Michael and Castroneves picked up the pace. They went to 26.7 second laps, but still, Dario's 3/10 of a second a lap quicker.
Franchitti nibbles a little more off of Elio Castroneves. Castroneves very definitely in tow, but still not enough to pull out and dart inside of Michael.
Well, right now, Carl Hogan's about to tell him that he's got 10 laps to go, and at that point, Castroneves knows that if he doesn't do something fairly desperate, fairly brave, it's going to be very, very difficult to get it done. And here comes Dario. He just keeps moving forward. That time, Paul, 4/10 of a second quicker on the last lap.
10 laps to go now, the final stages of this 300-mile run at Gateway International. Mario Andretti with Castroneves right behind him, but Elio does not seem to be able to find the combination that will put him alongside and around Michael. There he closes in, but look just back. Look at Franchitti. He continues to nibble away on this battle for the front.
Another 4/10 of a second on that lap, Paul. Now, it's a pretty long shot here, but he's closer than you think he is. He's getting closer and closer every lap. 3/10, 4/10. We'll see what it is as they pass the start-finish line.
Ariel just closes in another second. With 8 laps to go, he's going to be very definitely part of this battle at the front, and there is traffic that now lies ahead. This is going to make a world of difference. The first person they'll encounter is Scott Pruitt, and then Richie Hearn is just ahead of Scott.
And you can see there, Castroneves a little higher, Darrow even higher, looking for clean air. Traffic is going to be the break they're looking for.
Scott Pruitt shows Michael the outside. Castroneves closes, Franchitti closes more.
And that's
Michael Andretti from time to time just watches, looks back and forth to his mirrors.
And Paul, that was the first lap that Dario actually went a little slower than Castroneves.
Michael got around Pruitt, but Castroneves did not. Now he comes out, back in contact. Franchitti follows him. That cost Castroneves.
Good bit of professionalism by Paul Tracy, though. Paul, he just stayed at the outside, breathed the throttle a little bit to let both of them slip through there. But still, the damage was done.
By Scott Pruitt.
Absolutely.
Michael comes low under Richie Hearn. Castroneves uses Hearn for a toe. Franchitti's caught behind Hearn. Five to go. Franchitti now clears Hearn. First, second, and third are back together.
Second quicker that lap than Castroneves.
Once again, traffic is the issue. Shaggy Akiatori. First Andretti is by, then Castroneves is by. Again, Franchitti gets caught. It'll be Allanser Jr. that sits just ahead of the leaders now. Castroneves is there. He gets a toe, tries, darts out, doesn't do it. Now remember how long Allanser Jr. and Michael Andretti have been racing together. The two seniors of this sport, literally thousands of miles chasing one another.
You can see Al looking to the left, checking his mirrors there, Paul. He definitely doesn't want to get in the middle of this.
Lap and a half to go now. Michael Andretti with Allanser Jr. just ahead, Castroneves. Now it's going to be decision time. White flag comes out for Michael Andretti. One to go. And Michael Andretti gets around little Al. Castroneves does too. Al lets all three of them pass. Top three are still in contact. Onto the backstretch. Michael Andretti could well be on his way to a win. One more corner, and it doesn't look like Castroneves is going to have what it takes. There is still some traffic ahead. They come off of the corner. Michael Andretti roars toward the finish line, and Michael Andretti takes his 38th victory. It's been 24 races since Michael's last win. Neumannhaas takes the win. Helio Castroneves with a brilliant second, and Dario Franchitti in third. Now we're going to drop back and take a look at that battle back in the field. TJ Jones with Christian Fittipaldi working on him. Jimmy Vassar. And it looks like that is the way that they will come to the line as well. PJ tries to get rid of Fittipaldi, but he doesn't need that maneuver. So PJ Jones finishes in eighth place, followed by Fittipaldi and Jimmy Vassar. Andretti, Castroneves, Franchitti, Roberto Marino, and Mac Pappas. That's your top five. Michael Andretti wins the Motorola 300. We'll be back after this message and a word from your ABC station.
You're watching ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Well, 300 miles are complete, and Michael Andretti has taken the victory a very long dry spell. Michael Andretti is finally smiling. Let's take a look at the unofficial results, and in just a moment, we'll be talking with our newest champion. Of course, it is all unofficial. Michael Andretti, Castroneves, Franchitti comes away from contact with Paul Tracy and finishes in third. Roberto Marino gives his car a terrific ride. And there is the rest of the order had quite a bit of contact here today, but fortunately, no serious injury. Let's go to John Kernan.
And Michael Andretti in Victory Circle gets the big trophy. Michael, congratulations. Been a while.
A long while, way too long. It was just an awesome race. Firestone tires were incredible. We didn't change them last stop. We went almost two stints with them, and they just kept on going. It was just the guys called a perfect race with the pit stops and the strategy, and I'm just so happy for everybody at Kmart and Texaco, and you know, they all hung in there with us and finally brought one home after a while.
You know, that last pit stop got you guys out front. It was no tires, so you knew it was going to be quick. Does that make up for last year whenever Alex beat you?
Yeah, no question about it, but then you wonder, are they going to hold up? You know, you take that gamble to get track position, and the Firestones just hung in there incredibly well. I just can't believe it.
Now, Elio Castroneves closed the gap on you there at the end. How hard did you have to race him to stay out in front?
I was driving the hardest I've ever driven, I think, you know, just right on the edge. But I knew that he had fresher tires than me, so I had to run it to the edge, and it was hanging in there.
You can hear the emotion in Michael Andretti's voice, a very happy young man, to Marty Reed.
And you want to talk about emotion. The tears have been pulled away from Helio Castroneves, your best career finish here in the Kart FedEx Series, second place. Let me go back to the start. When you missed that first pit stop, did you think it was all over?
Yes, I thought it was all over. I knew I had such a great car. I really was upset. I told Carl, I'm sorry, like 100 times. And I have to thank him because he kind of told me, hey, come on, we still plan a race to go. And we did it. We finished on the podium.
Now you caught him, but you couldn't pass Michael. What was it, dirty air, just not enough tire?
Well, dirty air is mainly thing. Michael did such a good job. I mean, he's such a great experience. I mean, in my helmet, I was thinking, Jesus, this is Michael, it's me. I was so close to him to Carl, but next one. Next we're going to get him, I'm telling you.
This guy loves to race, and boy, does he put on a great show for us.
You know, he's going to watch that videotape a couple of thousand times and probably listen to Parker and say, you know, if I just pedaled back, which is pretty hard to do, maybe I could have come forward. We'll be back to talk with more of the competitors in the Motorola 300 and the run at Gateway right after this.
Few athletes that have maintained this lifelong commitment to be the best. And even fewer companies.
Here's the way the points look after six races. Despite finishing 11th, Juan Montoya stays at the top of the order. Daryl Franchitti stays in second, but Michael Andretti takes a massive move forward from sixth up to third place, and Christian Fittipaldi drops two positions from third down to fifth. John Kernan?
With Dario Franchitti. And Dario, just an amazing finish, third place, especially when you consider the contact that you had out on the racetrack with your teammate Paul Tracy.
Yeah, I mean, the first thing I want to say is the contact was very, very unfortunate. You know, I got a run on Paul. He didn't want to give any ground. I hit a bump in three, and that pushed my front over into him. Really, I was... We were really too close, and something had to give. But you know, the guys today did a good job on both sides of the team. I feel sorry for Paul's guys. We both had a good car. We both were running up the front, and I think with a slightly different strategy, we might have won. But we're going to take the points. We're very happy. I have to say, I'm very happy for the guys at Hogan Racing. You know, they've been waiting a long time since here 2 years ago, when we almost won the race. They deserve a podium. They've really been pushing hard for it. I feel happy for them. It was a good race today. It was incident filled.
But it was a good race, a lot of great competition out on the racetrack. Another guy with a good run is with Marty Reed.
The smile on Roberto Moreno's face, starting 19th, finished fourth. Man, you guys had some nice pit stops and some great strategy.
It was a fantastic race. Coming back from the back, and this morning we didn't have a very competitive car. We work as a team. The Motorola PacWest team did a great job to get the car in one piece and working well for the race. We took some chances and paid off. We worked as a team with Mauricio Guglielmi, and as you see, we came through the field. We did an excellent gamble on the pit stop. It paid off. we led the race. I had to build as much lead as possible. And the yellow came at the right point, and we didn't lose a lap, and we were very competitive at the end.
And you only got 500 more miles to drive tomorrow.
Yes, the biggest thing is to get up there. The helicopter ride here the other day was very, very slow. Today I'm taking a jet over there, and I'm very, very pleased with the Motorola PacWest team, and tomorrow we're ready for the 500.
Paul, I think he could fly there by himself.
Yeah, but I hope if he wins, his voice holds up. That's his best finish since third in 1996 at the U.S. 500. Again, the unofficial order of finish here in the Motorola 300. Well, the crowd's still hanging in here and keeping an eye on the ceremonies at the conclusion of the Motorola 300 here at Gateway International Raceway. Dave Stevens, now he was the crew member for Walker Racing that was injured. He has been taken to St. Louis University Hospital for a precautionary CAT scan. They're apparently worried about a consciousness level, but they emphasize it is precautionary. Now, Parker Johnstone, we're going to get an opportunity here we don't normally get. Let's go back. Look at the final three laps.
Paul, the key here is the strategy of the last pit stop. Michael Andretti, a splash and go, no new tires. Castro Neves, new tires and fuel. Michael driving flawlessly. He never made a mistake. Castro Neves, we saw the emotion, putting his heart and soul into trying to figure out how to get around Michael Andretti. And you can see there, Michael is within an eighth of an inch, as close as you can get, running that car right down the inside. A tremendous drive from Michael Andretti. Elio Castro Neves, they come up on Allenser Jr., and I must point out, Paul, watch what Al does. He leaves the inside open so that Michael and Elio can get clean air as he comes through turns 3 and 4, a true mark of a top-level professional. You'll see through here now, he's running high. He's doing that on purpose so Michael can stay low, get some air, and then Al does the greatest thing a top sportsman does. He just pulls off to the side and lets Michael, Elio, and Dario through. Michael now pushing so hard. So is Elio. So is Dario. Keep in mind, Michael, two stints on these Firestone tires, driving the wheels off the car. Elio giving it everything he can. And today, it wasn't enough, but still, celebration at Hogan Racing, at Newman Haas Racing for two outstanding drives. And Dario Franchitti coming back from disaster, near disaster, to finish third. Tremendous effort from these three fantastic drivers.
And Michael Andretti waving thank you to little Al as he goes past. And he takes the victory in the Motorola 300. We will be back with more in just a moment.
When you're in the zone and you're on the edge, and I mean the edge, but you're in control, and you can bring that sucker home in first place, that's heaven. Hell is when you put it in the fence.
The Motorola 300, brought to you by Motorola, a leader in wireless personal communications. Motorola lets you take your world with you. FedEx, proud sponsor of the FedEx Championship Series. Honda, proud sponsor of the 1999 FedEx Championship Series. And Firestone, America's tire since 1900.
Well, here in the Motorola 300, once again, the full field rundown for you with Michael Andretti winning. And he gets the point for leading the most laps. That's what that L means. And Montoya, the P is the extra point that is awarded for the pole. There were 11 cars on the leader lap at the finish and 12 cars out of the race. John Kernan.
And a fifth place finish for Max Pappas. Max, good run for you today.
You know, it was very, very good. You know, like Miller Lite car ran very well. We had a taste of the podium in the last 25 laps, but we're going to be there. And today we had two very special crew members, you know, that helped me out, and it was a great day for us. A
couple of big bodyguards, and I wouldn't be surprised in the next few races to see Max wind up in victory circle stairs.
So Max Pappas, who finishes unofficially in fifth place. Parker Johnstone, we saw an interesting and exciting day. A lot of contact, though.
It's the best racing that we've seen in 1999. And, Paul, I think as we enter the middle section of the season now, what you're starting to see is a little bit of desperation for some of the drivers, some of the teams. The first part of the year hasn't gone the way they've wanted to, and they're starting to force passes. They're trying to make things happen. And as close as this grid is, it's the most competitive form of open-wheel racing anywhere. The guys are running so close, just the slightest miscue from anyone, and you have an incident, but it makes for some great racing.
And again, we're going to show you the point standings with this race. Look how that whole thing tightens up. And as we approach the midpoint in the season, in 1 week, a week from tomorrow, we will be at the Miracle Mile in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. The Miller Lite 225 coverage will come right here on ABC Sports. And there is a track that always produces some terrific racing. So the CART FedEx Championship Series has 6 rounds now complete. The complexion of the championship begins to be a little more confused as Montoya is not able to score his 4 in a row. Our final spotlight, of course, we take a look back on this day here at Gateway International Raceway at St. Louis. We've had a good day. Congratulations to Michael Andretti. What a beautiful run. What a very bright run. And, of course, Hilo Castroneves and Dario Franchitti. This is Paul Page for Parker Johnstone, John Kernan, and Marty Reed. We hope you've enjoyed your time here. And make sure that you do join us 1 week from today, from tomorrow, at Milwaukee, Wisconsin, when these cars go at it again. Of course, tomorrow is the 83rd running of the Indianapolis 500-mile race with beautiful weather here in the Midwest. ABC Sports is online at ESPN.com, and that is part of the Go Network. This has been a presentation of ABC Sports, continuing the tradition of excellence.